বিধান আমার শুনতে পাচ্ছ?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, you are audible. Good morning, sir.
Wow. আমি শুনতে পাচ্ছি না এখানে।
Hello? Sir, you are audible to us.
But I think we are not audible to him.
Achha. Okay. হ্যালো সংযুক্তা দি, আই থিঙ্ক ইউ হ্যাভ প্রবাবলি পুট ইয়োরসেলফ অন মিউট।
গুড মর্নিং।
ইউজুয়াল সাসপেক্টস টার্নিং আপ এট জেন্ডার সেমিনার্স লাইক ব্যাড কয়েন্স।
The two, so I can see both the three speakers have joined. Niladri sir, Shangdukta ma'am, Mousumi ma'am, all the three speakers, they have joined. Good morning to all of you, ma'am.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you.
Mousumi, I don't think we've met, so hello.
Hi,
Mousumi is there. I can see her.
Yeah, I can see both of you too.
Yes, I don't think, Mousumi, have we ever met?
No, but I have listened to you in our English department. In fact, I'm quite aware about Shangyukta Di also. So okay. I know you to your work.
But we have met now. We have met now.
We haven't met.
Okay. Sati ma'am is yet to join. But I think we can start the inaugural.
Yeah. Yes, we can.
Yeah, that is for you, the coordinators, to decide.
Shall we begin then?
Yeah, we should begin. Meenakshi, so you.
I will start. Put myself on mute. Yeah. Mute
your audio as well. I think that would be better.
Vidhan, mute your screen.
Okay, ma'am. I will request all the participants to mute your speaker.
Okay. So I'm beginning, okay?
Yeah, Meena.
Am I audible to all of you?
Yes, you are.
Okay, thank you. So let us begin. A very good morning to our respected principal, sir, our honored guests, and all the other listeners who have joined us for today's webinar on the politics of gender representation in media, critical perspectives, a collaborative effort of Department of English and Department of Mass Communication, Kandra Radhakanto Kundu Mahabiddalaya. On behalf of the family of our college, I, Meenakshi Pal, assistant professor in the Department of English of our college, welcome all of you who have joined us for today's webinar. I find immense pleasure to extend my deep regards to all the eminent and renowned personalities of both the academia and media who have joined us today for the panel discussion, and I welcome them on the behalf of our college. Let me quickly introduce each one of them to you. I welcome Professor Shonjukta Dasgupta, professor and former head in the Department of English, University of Calcutta. Professor Niladri Chatterjee, Department of English, University of Kollani. Dr. Moshami Bhattacharjee, professor in the Department of Journalism and Mass Communication, Bishwa Bharati. And Swati Bhattacharjee, an eminent journalist and well-known researcher. So without any further delay, I would like to request Ria Hajari, a fifth semester student of our college, who will be inaugurating this webinar with a song dedicated to Ardashok.
দুঃখের বুঝি নাই বুঝি মা
Hello, are you done, Ria?
Okay,
thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Chondo rupe namostute, Srishti rupe mamastha bhayam trahi mam sharnagatam. Thank you so much, Ria, for your wonderful performance. Really, this invocation of Ma Durga is the real need of the hour to fight the demon who materialized today in the form of the virus, indeed. I hope that we can witness the uprising of this Adishakti situated in every woman, anticipating a new world of equality and freedom. But at the same time, this valorization of women as Shakti could not fail to appeal our critical aptitude, making us conscious of the significant role that media, art, culture, cinema contribute to manufacture the image of womanhood in our society. So let us begin this two-day journey of unraveling the politics behind this enterprise of image building. Ladies and gentlemen, at this point, I would like to make an attempt of introducing you to the main subject of today's discussion. In this neoliberal late capitalist age, media has been well enterprising its role in developing multiple narratives of the world in almost all possible dimensions through its diversified manifestations spanning the fields of cinema, television, advertising, print media. Women have historically been associated with the consumption of media rather than its production. Social media have simplified and democratized the means for visual creation, editing, and distribution. This has allowed the issue of gender easier access to the tools of media production and distribution. This has enabled us not only to envisage a world with the more porous boundaries of gender, but even to question the seeming ontological foundation of the essence of gender itself. The present webinar attempts to explore
the fashion in which media and popular culture have navigated this demand of transgressing the conventional gender codes, decoding the gender politics, and ushering us to an era of constantly evolving gender identities. It endeavors to witness the collaboration that media and popular culture manage to evolve with the theoretically impregnated notion of feminism, and also to assess the progress made in this direction. These representations can normalize diversity and challenge restrictive views of the representation of women. The aim of this webinar is to provide a theoretical contribution to gender studies as well as to feminist media studies. Now, I would like to request our principal, sir, Dr. Mrinal Kanti Chattopadhyay, to grace the occasion with his valuable words. Sir.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you to everyone for attending our national webinar. I do hereby welcome the respected speakers, guests, delegates, and students who are present here from the different part of country to grace the occasion of today's national webinar titled The Politics of Gender Representation in Media, Critical Perspective, organized by English Department and Mass Communication and Journalism Department of our college. The village Kandra is the birthplace of famous Vaishnava romantic poet Gyanudas. Bodhu, tomar garave garavini ami, rupushi tomar rupe, hano mone, thadaloiya rakhibuke. কেন দাসের এই রচনা আমাদের আজও গর্বিত করে। ইট হ্যাজ এ রিচ হেরিটেজ অফ ভিটাইবল বেঙ্গলি লিটারেচার অ্যান্ড কালচার। ইট ইজ রিপ্লেট উইথ রিলিজিয়াস ইন্টারেস্ট। আওয়ার কলেজ কান্দ্রা রাধাকান্ত কুন্ডু মহাবিদ্যালয় ওয়াজ এস্টাবলিশড ইন 2001। দেয়ার ইজ এ রিমার্কেবল চেঞ্জ অফ দ্য কলেজ ইন লাস্ট ফিউ ইয়ার্স ইন অল রেসপেক্ট। The college affiliated of Bardhaman University, it is duly recognized by the UGC under Section 2F and 12B under UGC Act. The beautiful environment of our college, it has all the arrangement for the overall development of the students. Our dedicated staff and teachers serve approximately 2,500 students at present. In addition to the core curriculum, the college offers learning support and career guidance to the students so that they become the productive citizens and future leaders. We are running the college as a family. We are turning to make the purpose of the college a reality. Our topic, gender and media, is an important issue in present scenario. This will be discussed today. We are proud to have this eminent scholar today in our webinar, Professor Sanjukta Das Gupta, Calcutta University. Namaskar, madam. Professor Niladri Chatterjee, Kollani University. Namaskar, sir. Professor Mousami Bhattacharya, Vishwabharati. আপনাকেও আমাদের কলেজের তরফ থেকে ধন্যবাদ জানাচ্ছি। অ্যান্ড সুপ্রীতিম পাল, সিনিয়র অ্যাসিস্ট্যান্ট এডিটর, পুনে মিরর, এদের সকলকে আমরা আমাদের কলেজের তরফ থেকে শুভেচ্ছা এবং ধন্যবাদ জানাচ্ছি। উই আর প্রিভিলেজড।
স্যার, এক মিনিট স্যার, একটু ইন্টারাপ্ট করলাম আপনাকে। হ্যাঁ, একটু চেঞ্জ হয়েছে স্কেডিউলটা। হ্যাঁ, আজকে ওই সুপ্রতিম পাল যিনি বলার কথা ছিলেন উনি গতকাল বলবেন, আর ওই স্বাতী ভট্টাচার্য ম্যাম আজকে বলবেন।
আচ্ছা, ঠিক আছে, থ্যাংক ইউ। সাথী ভট্টাচার্য, আপনাকে আমাদের কলেজের তরফ থেকে অনেক ধন্যবাদ জানাচ্ছি। উই আর প্রিভিলেজড দ্যাট দে হ্যাভ অ্যাকসেপ্টেড আওয়ার ইনভিটেশন টু অ্যাড্রেস দেয়ার ভ্যালুয়েবল ইনসাইট থ্রু দেয়ার স্পিচ ইন এ ন্যাশনাল ওয়েবিনার। আই হোপ টুডে ডিসকাশন উইল বি সাকসেসফুল অ্যান্ড উই উইল লার্ন এ লট অ্যাবাউট দিস। আই উড অলসো লাইক টু থ্যাংক our respected GB members, GB president, teachers, non-teaching staff and students and all those who have been their active support to organize the national webinar. Special thanks Vidhan Mondal, Meenakshi Pal, Shahbaz Ahmed Mondal, Shafiqul Alam of Department of English and Mass Communication and Journalism Department. I would also like to thank our advisory committee members, Professor Subrata Mondal, Professor Manavendra Das, Professor Chandrata Pandpal, Professor Bajaraj Pal, Somnath Dutto, Sayyed Mahmud Ali, Ajit Hajra. Once again, I welcome you to our college and pray for grand success of this national webinar. এই অতি মহামারীর সময়েতে আপনারা সকলে সুস্থ থাকুন, ভালো থাকুন এই কামনা করে আমি আজকে বক্তব্য শেষ করছি এবং আমরা অধীর আগ্রহে অপেক্ষা করছি আজকের এই বিষয়টিকে শোনার জন্য। নমস্কার।
Thank you so much, sir, for your precious words. Your words have always been a source of inspiration for all of us. I hope that we shall always be enlightened by your vast knowledge. We hope that under your guidance, we shall be able to do more for the college. Now, as we have reached to the main core part of today's session, I would request my colleague, Mr. Vidhan Mondal, to please introduce our speakers for the day and invite them for delivering their lectures. Over to you. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you, Meenakshi. Good morning, respected principals, honorable speakers, all the participants, my colleagues, and my beloved students. Thank you all for being normalized with us in this new normal. I will take this opportunity to convey my regards to our principal, Sir Dr. Minal Kanti Chattopadhyay, for inspiring and guiding us to organize this two-day national webinar. I want to share my sincere gratitude to all the four speakers today for accepting our invitation. We are very, very fortunate to have your gracious presence with us. Well, we have the end of the inaugural session. Now we will move on to the next session without any further delay. Before I introduce our speakers, if I would like to address the participants, if you have any questions, queries, observations, you may send us by dropping your text in the comment box during the presentation. After the presentation, we will take them with the kind permission of our speakers. Well, now it is my privilege to introduce our first speaker, Professor Sangyukta Dasgupta, ma'am. Professor Sangyukta Dasgupta is professor and former head Department of English and former Dean of Arts, Calcutta University. She is a poet, critic, and translator. She is the recipient of numerous national and international grants, awards, and fellowships, and has delivered lectures, taught, and read her poems and short stories in India and abroad. She was the chairperson of Commonwealth Writers' Prize UK. She is a member of General Council of Sahitya Academy, New Delhi, and convener of the English Advisory Board, Sahitya Academy. She is also the president of the Intercultural Poetry and Performance Library at ICCR, Kolkata. She has written many books, both edited and co-edited, that include Her Stories, 20th Century Bengali Women Writers, Tagore at Home in the World, Swadesh, Tagore's Patriotic Songs, Radical Rabindranath, Nation, Family, and Gender in Tagore's Fiction and Films, the novels of Huxley and Hemingway, A Study in Two Planes of Reality, The Indian Family in Transition, Media, Gender, and Popular Culture in India, Tracking Change and Continuity, and so on. Two more publications under Sahitya Academy are awaited in 2020. In Memoriam, English Translations of Tagore's Poems, and C, Contemporary Short Stories by Indian Women Writers. So we are very lucky to have you with us, ma'am. So now I will invite our first speaker, Professor Songdipta Dasgupta, ma'am. The title of her talk is Image and Identity, Media Representations of India Women in Contemporary Times. Women's participation, performance, and portrayal in media are three important dimensions of study. Different circumstances relating to the media's role towards portraying the fair sex have opened up a new angle to think precisely about the image and identity of women as represented by the Indian media at contemporary times. In this context, the title of this talk is very much relevant, and we are all expecting Songdipta ma'am to enrich us with her lecture. So, ma'am, over to you.
Thank you, Vidhan, for that very generous introduction, and a very good morning to all of you who are now present in the Google Room, as I have just learned to address any sort of platform which is virtual. And so, as Vidhan rightly pointed out, that this is a new normal. And though for me, it is all still very, very abnormal, but at the same time, I'm trying to get acclimatized to this new normal. And in that spirit, I would like to wish everybody a very good morning. And of course, my sincere gratitude to Principal Mrinal Kanti Chattopadhyay of Kandra Radhakanto Kundu College for inviting me. And Vidhan has been a wonderful facilitator. He has been in touch with me and has also encouraged me to be, because I'm not a media expert, I'm just a cultural commentator, but he encouraged me to make this presentation, see what I make of it. And of course, I'm also very grateful to the young person who sang the song from Rabindranath, invoking the Devi, and also to Meenakshi Paul, who began the program. And the invocation also is a part of the beginning of Devi Pokkho. And I think if you reflect on that, you will find that Devi Pokkho is just for a few weeks. The rest is Pitri Pokkho. So it begins from there, shall we say? In the social imaginary, Indian women in the 21st century are often subjected to comparison with venerable female icons of ancient India, from divine female protagonists to the dominant female figures of epics and myths. As a result, women's self-confidence meets a wall of resistance, as along with literary texts and the traditional print media, the avant-garde digital media scape consolidates these traditional images deified by patriarchy, though there are evidences of subverting these stereotypes as well. The roles of the new news media, films, and advertisement will be critiqued in my presentation today to trace how change and continuity are fused in 21st century Indian societal practices and cultural values. In his recent book, The Idea of Justice, Amartya Sen has specifically identified the role of an unrestrained and healthy media that can generate direct contribution of free speech, as well as informational role, protective function, and formation of values, all of which can facilitate and enhance the quality of life of the people, both the advantaged and disadvantaged classes. Amartya Sen emphasizes that freedom of the media can stimulate public reasoning and response. And though he mentions the print media alone, the same can be related to the role of the visual media as well. It is a role that is also about responsibility for a partisan, biased and controlled media may lead to more harm than good. A restricted media administered by a regulatory body can shrug off responsibility, but the free media has greater responsibility in terms of ethics. It is often noticed that the media can stake ethics and national interest for the sake of the consumable story. However, the oppressive and exploitative factor of women's bodies, the embodiment and encoding of women's sexuality, emerge as concerns among cyborg affiliates and theories and practices of post-modern feminism and cyber feminism. Even the liberating technological domains remain male-centered instead of gender-neutral. In the post-human, post-gendered, meat and metal cybernetic conceptions too, the defining roles of women remain ambiguous and ambivalent. In an essay titled Cyberspace, Feminism and Technology, we find that there are references that despite technological advancement and the liberating environment that the internet provides, it is in visual pornography that women's bodies are most prevalent, thereby suggesting the persistence of the notion of cyclical progression, which is regulatory and exploitative in its representation of young women's bodies as the perennial and ultimate seduction. This poses many questions about how are we representing the world, and in terms of gender neutrality, in terms of ignoring alternative sexualities, in terms of compulsory heterosexuality, in terms of homophobia, which of course Niladri will expand upon. He is an expert in that area. I will stick to the known binaries of male-female heterosexuality. So this query that I have raised here, it poses the decision makers, the intention of decision makers and investors in internet components and literature that uses inputs on race, sexuality, class, religion, and gender categories attuned to market demands, which are determined by patriarchy and capitalism. In a particular Sunday Times issue some time back, it was reported that pirated Japanese video game Rayplay was available in India and could not be banned by a cyber vigilance facility. In this sexually graphic video game, the player is expected to rape a woman and her two teenage daughters. The report stated further, the internet is today littered with games that allow players not just to undress and grope women characters, but to tie them up, torture, and rape them. So that is the advancement in terms of culture and in terms of civilization of the 21st century, despite advancement of technology. Our minds don't seem to have changed too much. So my presentation today will be a visual presentation based on an assembly of slides. After all, what is media without pictures, which are a substitute for millions of words? But the niggling question worries us. Is the image synonymous with identity? Is the picture the person? Let's explore through these visual images whether we can reach the identity and the ideological and intersectional parameters that define identity. Is this the era of information, or is it in fact the era of disinformation, according to the recently released documentary film, Social Dilemma? Is this the era of post-truth and market-driven media drugs that cause mindless addiction? And the worst sufferers are once again women and all minority groups in terms of victimization. Within the time allotted to me, I hope to rush through these slides if the techno god Vishwakarma supports my karma. Dekhi akon ki hoy. Parikina. To do this. Can you see anything? Can you see the slideshow?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, thank you. Pirachi, my God, yes. I'm so tense. All right. So I'll just rush through these slides, and if there are questions, I will be very happy to answer them if they are not very difficult. All right. So you see, we cannot say that there is an absolutely a sort of a binary opposition between the old and the new in terms of media representations. The old media rarely die. Their original functions are adapted and absorbed by newer media. So the mutation goes on. The process of media transition is always a mix of tradition and innovation, always declaring for evolution, not revolution. But that can be dangerous in terms of gender representation if you carry on that traditional baggage of patriarchy. So these are all successful women. These are all women we admire, irrespective of gender. And is this the face of the Indian woman? Are these the faces of Indian women of the 21st century and the 20th century? Are these the faces of Indian women who are participating so actively in various protest platforms? And who are these? Are these Indian women as well? The silent majority, who the media does not ever seem to make a story about unless they are gang-raped, unless they are assaulted, unless a huge number of them suddenly die for some reason or the other. What are the desirable images that we see everywhere? In the print media, in the visual media, these shining, fair and lovely faces and with scanty clothes, yes? Generally, whenever you see a media representation of a very attractive woman, you can take it for granted that there is a very serious textile crisis in the country. And as a result, women's clothes are the skimpiest ever imaginable. But when you look at men's suits, you find that they are so well covered. An objectification of women. We just love these images, don't we? And we have admired them, never critiqued them, interrogated these images, nor have we raised any questions. So, as you find that always the objectification of women is about one woman surrounded by many men who are gawking at her. And the contrast in real life, that was Bollywood images, the item numbers, as you know. I believe they have all shifted to Bhojpuri films now. So the contrast, and see the contrast. And it is because of the persistence of this contrast, the 300 million upwardly mobile urban class of India, and almost 70% of the others who work mostly in unorganized sectors and whom we never notice are juxtaposed here you know, in terms of a very disturbing contrast. Similarly here, in terms of contrast. Is this tokenism? Is this representation? Is this something that really covers the whole of India? All the more than billion people that we are now? What are the common global images of women in the media, which are both global and also global, local, and local, whichever way you want to look at it? The glamorous sex kitten is, of course, the most desirable female. The sainted mother, the mother cannot be glamorous nor sexy. The devious witch, so if you're neither a mother nor a sex kitten, but if you have a mind of your own, you're invariably a witch. And the hard-faced corporate woman, the woman achiever, who seems to be the most selfish, independent woman under the sun. And the political climber, of course, is one who challenges the structures. And so she also is a persona to be feared. And this is the UNESCO report. And look at the CEDAW, Convention to Eliminate All Forms of Discrimination Against Women. These are such old, really old in terms of the way we look at the media nowadays. Yes, anything which is more than 10 minutes old seems to be so antiquated and obscure. And so, and looked upon as something that can be trashed as not being relevant anymore. So, but then, what the Beijing conference, which is quoted all the time, tried to do is to emphasize the role of the media as one of the 12 critical areas of concern. What is the media representing? But the media is absolutely under the control of crony capitalism, as you know, as Meenakshi in the morning, when she was just introducing the topic, talked about the neoliberal policies. And of course, the neoliberal policies look upon everything as production. And so human beings are also objectified, and we are all part of a human capital. And there ends the matter. But the dream in 1937 was something like this. Yes, it's a full stainless steel sculpture. And it's just beautiful in terms of claiming that equality, gender equality, these are two workers. A worker in the farm, the woman is a farm worker, the man is an industrial worker. This was a very famous statue and made out of stainless steel. Also the reason where in terms of emphasizing that metallurgy had come here to stay. So farming and metallurgy, industry and farmlands. And of course, since yesterday or the last few days, we are so aware of the farmers' protest. And some of the crucial questions, therefore, is how do different media represent women? How has social media affected the mainstream media's representation of women and gender? Has a proclaimed programmatic attitudinal shift of the media's reportage on women been effective in presenting a more inclusive understanding of gender roles and sexualized bodies? So let us very quickly look at women in Indian cinema. Some of these movies you might have heard of, you might have seen in YouTube, because these are movies mostly the young students who are part of, who have joined this particular webinar. These were movies before they were born, the few slides that I'll show, and then I'll come to more contemporary times. Mother India, about which you have heard, 1957. So this was the struggling woman. Remember the farmer image of the woman? And then women again. Struggling women, assertive women, women with minds of their own. And then, of course, do you remember the mantra of this film? Entertainment, entertainment, and entertainment. And so it goes, entertainment. And this is the young urban India, yes? And what is very ironical about this image is the number of bouncers that a woman needs to, if she becomes a star. And some movies which have been so positive in terms of ventilating some of the concerns of women. Gulabi Gang, which many of you may have watched, a movie that should have been watched more widely, Lakshmi. I don't know why it disappeared from the attention of the media, but probably because of the simple fact that the media cannot tolerate too much of threatening images. And here I have not included in my slide a movie which just came about recently, Shakuntala Devi, the mathematical genius. And that film, which was so good, and it's a very strong feminist film, and it has virtually disappeared. So this sort of a subtle discrimination of media control is something we need to notice and interrogate. And movies which, again, Mardani at least was watched, recognized in the UK also in a big way, but Parched should have won many more awards and noticed much more. But again, it disappeared. It was also made by a female director. And then the stereotype, Pink, which was hailed as a feminist film. But what is dominating Pink? Look at even the image. Look at the poster. Of course, the Don. Yes? So, and when we find a movie like Kahani, we thought it was a feminist film, till we find that in the last scenes, there seems to be a sort of a panic to get back to the convention where the woman really cries and says, oh, I am so sad, I have no husband and I lost my child. And then Much Ado About Signifying Stereotypes. Remember? Visual spectacle. The most beautiful film we have watched in recent times. But then what is it trying to glorify? Let's not even go there. Yes? So, women sacrificing themselves. Yes, not just one or two, but a huge number of women jumping into the blazing fire. And the game changers, movies that should have carried a much stronger message. Secret Superstar disappears. Mary Cobb disappears after making some ripples. And especially Secret Superstar, where the woman, for the first time, tells of her husband that he cannot carry on domestic violence the way he was used to. And the movie does not create the waves that Dangal did. Strange. And now let us come to women in movie, in TV serials, the afternoon addiction of many women and men. And so these are all joint families and women who are absolutely overdressed, and they go to bed also dressed like that, it seems. And of course, it has to be a joint family and a joint business family, very, very rich, where everybody is dissatisfied and everybody is quarreling. In other words, economic stability and economic performance does not determine happiness. Yes, happiness quotient is something very different. These are movies which outline that. And somehow, going reflecting back to the epics, to the epicenter of what is happening right now, it is the women who are the most quarrelsome, the women who are the conspirators. It's like saying that if the argumentative Indian is the man, the quarreling Indian is the woman. And so these are the known pictures of women. And then look at that, Punar Vivah. So you can keep on marrying, yes, serial marriages. And of course, again, that stereotype of the mother-in-law. And what probably one desires, but because of very active laws, still we are able not to allow this to happen, is the child bride. But however, if you take statistics or if you just go into the non-urban areas of the country, I think we can get a good number of these in our files about child marriages. Women in advertisements. Once again, see the contrast. Yes, always the man being surrounded by many women, single man, many women, and see how they are pampering him. See that. Yes, and the man looks so triumphant. Yes, and the body as commodity. Yes, fast track advertisements. Body as commodity. And then the protest that happened in Park Street. But once again, that very provocative body. Advertisements of condoms, advertisements of even various sorts of fruit juices. Look at that. Go vegetarian. And skin whitening, a national obsession. If you look carefully at the picture on the right, which is a huge poster under which there are many stalls, see the color of this, notice the color of the skin of the people selling wares, and notice the advertisement. And in the media, we have noticed that due to very, very good photoshopping or whatever they are called, or airbrushing or whatever the device facilities that are available to make faces longer, to make people look fairer, to make the hair look thicker. Everything is about a constructed, unreal image. And the 21st century obsession with selfies. Yes? And the selfies of the not the real image of the person, but absolutely an accentuated construction of a desirable image, which the person aspires to and remains dissatisfied. You will notice this very well if you watch Social Dilemma, where there is one little comment about somebody saying that your ears are a little big. And the young girl is totally obsessed and she's constantly touching her ears. Even when covered by hair, she is not comfortable. So that is body shaming. That is creating dissatisfaction, which of course would lead to women visiting those gyms and various beauty parlors, which are like torture chambers where you pay to be tortured. And the invisible majority. Yes, look at the NGO director and the two of them sitting together, and look at the other women. Look at even the skin colors. And now, women in contemporary print and visual news media, let us look at some of these images. How are we doing for time, Bidhan? Is there still time to go through these?
Yes, ma'am, you may continue. Okay. Not a problem.
Thank you. So, you might, this was just before, I think around 2008 or 9, when suddenly the Telegraph newspaper made all these administrators, the members of the India, of the Bengal government, wear saris. And this was not to compliment them, not to say that they are all really transgendered personalities, but to demean women. And Nabanita Dev Sen and others sent a letter to the Telegraph, signed by intellectuals, more than 100 intellectuals, saying that you cannot disgrace and demean and insult women in this manner. And now let us come to something more recent, like the Delhi gang rape. Yes, the protests were effective and certain laws were made much more stringent and some acts were even revised. But this goes on. This is much more recent, late 2018, 2019. This is all part of recent memory. You can't say this was long ago. You remember the restriction in the Sabarimala temple and what went on as a result when the Supreme Court passed a judgment that women could enter the temple? And then the Me Too movement, again, variously interpreted. Yes? And it is, was it about breaking the silence? Was it only about the Bollywood? Isn't Me Too something that is in every home? In terms of exploitation and assault and injury to women, it all begins, unfortunately, not in the public domain. The first rehearsal begins at home. Gender discrimination. And so, stop touching me. Notice that, yes? Not just the film industry. It is happening all the time, everywhere. And in the domestic space, in the bedroom, domestic violence, there are no CCTVs. And the total dearth of FIRs in police stations against domestic violence is a major issue of worry throughout the world, not in India alone. Sabarimala, I just spoke about that. Defilement and purification, women are defiled and so the temple has to be purified so that men can go in. And of course, the 50 lakh women who assembled there in Kerala against the sort of social protest. And pandemic times. So have we changed? Some reflect that maybe in these pandemic times, I have heard this, that what women's liberation movement could not achieve, the pandemic times has achieved, coronavirus has achieved. Men are helping with work at home. Men are washing utensils. Men are helping with cooking. Men are helping with mopping and cleaning of the house. But where are the statistics? It is happening. I know that for sure because my husband is doing all this. So, but then is it happening in every house? What is being reported in the media, in the print media? See, it triggers a domestic violence in times of COVID. Isolation with a manipulative partner. Major financial crunch, anxiety due to uncertainty. And one of the major issues is job loss. And the fact that the man is totally in the home 24/7, which is leading to this sort of domestic violence. And then the migrant workers. Here too, the women seem to be the worst sufferers. The traumatic walk. Yes, and the woman carrying a child, carrying bags, and also being responsible for providing whatever food possible to her family. And the media trial, which happened very recently, as you know, the Riya Chakravarti case. And of course, the shift in focus starts off with the suicide, which again is variously interpreted. And now the woman, the iconic film star, takes on the entire government of Maharashtra. So, of course, this is not really a gender issue. It is a deeply political issue where women are being used. But then, if we come away from Bollywood, then what do we notice? That nothing really has changed. A 14-year-old patient raped in India's largest COVID-19 facility, that's in Kerala. 3 migrant workers arrested over gang rape of a 14-year-old. A COVID-19 patient raped inside an ambulance in Kerala. And these have happened recently in the month of September. So I'm a little tempted to read this poem of mine, which happened to, which just came out of me when I watched the film Delhi Crime in March 2019. It was just a bus ride home, Mama, just a bus ride home at 10 that evening. But it was a bus full of hyenas. 6 of them, or 16, or were they 60? Even my friend pawed me like a hyena, while the others watched, licking their lips, saliva dripping from their wet, sloppy, lolling tongues. They pounced on me, they stripped me stark nude. They manhandled every part of my helpless body. They bit me, slapped me, twisted my protesting arms. They raped me again and again and again. They thrust an iron rod into the recess from which one day my baby could have slid out into this beautiful world. The terrified tunnels of my trembling body. The rest is history. The police, the hospital, my recorded statements, the protests. But life left me. I died far away from home. I died far away from my homeland. What a first trip abroad it was for me. But no, I haven't left. Each winter night in December, you may still find me if you look carefully, standing next to that ditch at the dead of night, standing on the lonely bus route, my blood dripping intestines spilling out. Tell me, what was my mistake? Friends, teachers, parents, politicians, and priests. So this is a book that I worked on with along with 2 of my colleagues of Calcutta University. And what we notice is the 5 groups that we are trying to emphasize here on: gender stereotyping, perpetuating patriarchy, exploitation of the female body, sexual debauchery, homophobia, and body image, which is also about body shaming. The United Nations, in its Sustainable Development Goals by 2030, has, and already we have just got 10 years more, and has emphasized that step it up for gender equality, media compact. And the media should focus on gender equality and women's rights by reporting disrupting stereotypes and biases, increasing the number of women in the media, inclusion in leadership, and decision-making roles. So let us hope Planet 50-50 by 2030. That is equal rights, equal opportunities, complete gender equality. And now, the most important slide. Thank you so much for your patience and indulgence.
Thank you, thank you, thank you very much, Sangeeta ma'am. Such an inspiring and enriching lecture. We have really enjoyed your presentation, and what a wonderful poem.
Thank
That's
you.
Really, really moving. So, Professor Sangeeta Dasgupta ma'am, she has stressed how change and continuity are fused in 21st century Indian societal practices and cultural values. she has showcased the disturbing contrast of representation of women in the media, especially in the cinema, Indian cinema, TV serials, advertisement. That is, there are still continuing the stereotyping of women and showcasing the binaries of argumentative men versus quarreling women. So nothing has changed yet. So we all agree with you, ma'am. So now we have a number of questions. Should I take them, ma'am?
Depends on the time. I do not want to disturb the time allotted to Niladri. So if you could take all those questions and make it one question. No,
I will take two questions.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, first of all, Meenakshi Paul, she has a question. Meenakshi, I request you to unmute yourself and ask the question.
Okay, thank you. Ma'am, I just wanted to ask that in a way, capitalism in this neoliberal world, it can be blamed for aggravating the gender inequality. I mean, we hoped that it would actually annihilate the gender inequality, but this never happened. So can we say that if capitalism withdraws from the society, there are chances of re-establishing gender equality?
Yes, but that is an utopian fantasy. Yes, because there is no way in which we can absolutely uproot capitalism, because the human being is not really geared for equality. The human being loves rivalry, loves competition, loves everything which we consider to be the deadly sins in terms of the Christian understanding, in terms of also the sins which are identified both in our Hindu religious scripts as well as the Buddhist religious scripts and the Jain religious scripts. There are many other religions in the world. I do not think any of them will differ. And therefore, there is this notion of being a little better than the others. Otherwise, what's the point? Yes. So if you have a car, which is maybe a Maruti Suzuki Desire or something, then the other person must have a Honda. Otherwise, what's the point? And so, you know, in terms of these new liberal policies, this sort of a market-driven world where you have to be a little better than the other person, which is why we are so obsessed with selfies, that we have to be the very best in terms of that image construction. I think we will not very, at least not in my lifetime, I hope in your lifetime, you can do something about uprooting capitalism. It is a very, very, very deeply rooted. So how to do that, I think I will leave it to the young citizens of our country.
Thank you, ma'am. And now we will take another question. Ma'am, Somnath Mondol, he is a brilliant student of our department. And Somnath has a question. I will request Somnath to mute. Somnath, please mute yourself and you can ask the question by yourself.
Somnath, ke to dekhte ho pari ami.
Somnath, please.
Or is it not allowed? Otherwise, never mind. Let him unmute.
It's allowed, ma'am. Somnath, can you listen to me?
Yes, sir.
Please yes, sir, make yourself both audible and visible.
Okay, so please your voice. Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, Shubhnath.
Ma'am, I have a question.
Tell me.
We see in the Western countries that women are also objectified. So I ask you, is there gender equality is not present there? And suppose we have eradicated women body objectification from our in Indian TV programs. So what major changes will come that will lead gender equality?
Well, in Western countries, when the second women's liberation movement happened, it was a women's liberation movement. The second one was not for voting rights, that had already been gained in around 1918-1919. The fallout of which was that in India, we didn't have to have a women's voting rights movement at all. It was automatic. As soon as India became independent, all men and women voted. All citizens had equal rights. But in the West, they had to fight for it for a long time till they gained voting rights just after the First World War. Now, but that doesn't mean that there is gender equality. If you notice the number of films that focuses on domestic violence as well as harassment of women in public places, also the statistics in terms of date rapes that happen, you will be horrified to know that what seems to be otherwise so different from our culture, and we feel that, well, in the West, all women are free. If women were really free, they would not have worn stilettos. Yes, what is the difference between stilettos and foot bounding? Yes, so the binding of feet and stilettos, if you try wearing a pair of stilettos, you will understand what I'm trying to say. Like if you try getting into a ronpa or something. So you have to really keep your body so fit so that you can walk around in stilettos. But men have such comfortable shoes. It is only of late from the West that shoes of women have become a little better instead of that perennial choti that we used to wear. Yes, covered shoes are required for the protection of the feet. But in terms of women's apparel, in terms of the politics of clothing is also very interesting, but we do not have time to go into all that. But you just try to think in terms of the emphasis of the clothes of women also. So in the West, however, too, if you see even the film festivals, the way the women are dressed. Yards and yards of clothing, and yet the shapely leg must be revealed. There should be a good view of the cleavage. And so the emphasis, again, the objectification of female bodies becomes such a normative practice, both in the First World, in the global arena, as well as in our local arena, especially in our urban areas. There is a great difference in terms of class-based analysis. We cannot do that here because we don't have that sort of time. Which class is adhering to imitation of the West? How many are able to do that? How many visit these malls and pick up those clothes? And I remember a student of mine, I said that, oh, those clothes are so expensive. The ones in the shopping malls. She said, no, ma'am, it doesn't matter. You just go into the changing rooms and the fitting rooms and take a selfie of yourself in those wonderful clothes and then come out and post it on FB. Yes, you don't have to buy it. But that means there is a dissatisfaction in your own image. And so in terms of India, Shomnath, I think it will take a very, very long time for anything to change, because non-threatening images is what the media is afraid of. If the non-threatening image of an independent woman driving to the office in her own car, living in her own flat, which she has bought, and who cooks for herself instead for the family, is not what the media would want. Even if the woman is a nanoscientist, she will be shown as a nanoscientist who can also make such wonderful aloo ka paratha. Yes. So that's the way in which this sort of consolidation of stereotypes is maintained. Yes, a nanoscientist, if he's male, nobody cares what he can make or what he can do other than what is part of his own profession. But in terms of a woman, she has to be caring, she has to look after her children, and if she fails to do that, see, Shakuntala Devi. And how the movie was considered to be a threat and therefore not as publicized as it should have been, where the daughter feels that she will be denied the property and goes off to put her mother in jail. And the mother says, all my life I have worked towards making you an independent individual, and you have come here to put me to jail, in the jail, but I have given you everything I had. And immediately the daughter falls in love with the mother. So, you know, these stereotypes are so deeply ingrained in the psychic terrain of our social conditioning that it is not going to be in a hurry that we will observe any sort of social change. I'm sorry to sound so pessimistic.
Thank you very much, ma'am. And coincidentally, the student you have mentioned about, she is present with us.
Oh,
she's
really?
The coincidence, he has just shared with us the information.
Yeah.
Well, so we have a few more questions, but time's winged chariot is hurrying. So I beg your pardon. So yeah. Now we will move on to the next session.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you,
myself a lot.
Okay, so now we will move on to the next session. It's my privilege to introduce our new speaker, and second speaker, Professor Niladri Ranjan Chatterjee. He is a professor and head of the Department of English, University of Kulani in West Bengal. His doctoral work is on the novelist Christopher Isherwood. His research areas include specifically culture studies, gender studies, and LGBT studies. He is a recipient of Fulbright Scholarship and British Council Charles Wallace Fellowship. He has many publications to his credit. He has written the book, The Scholar, co-edited the books, The Muffled Heart, Stories of the Disempowered Bell, and Nari Vaag, Androgyny and Female Impersonation in India, contributed to the American Isherwood, and so on. He has published in the journal American Notes and Queries, Intersections, and has recently begun contributing to the WAC. He has reviewed for Gay and Lesbian Review worldwide, and he has been teaching a course in gender studies at his university since 2009. We are very lucky to have you, sir. And today, he will be speaking on the title of his talk, is Love and the Section 377 Supreme Court Verdict of 2018. Now, homosexuality was never illegal or a criminal offense in ancient Indian and traditional courts, but was criminalized by the British during their rule in India through the Section 377. On 6th of September 2018, the Supreme Court unanimously ruled that Section 377 is unconstitutional as it infringed on the fundamental rights of autonomy, intimacy, identity, and thus legalizing homosexuality in India. But the homophobia still remains among the Indian LGBT people, despite having the right. They cannot express their love as normally as heterosexuals do. Professor Chatterjee will be elucidating these discriminated, closeted, challenged love stories. So, sir, over to you.
Yes, thank you so much, Bidhan, for a far too long introduction. Thanks also to the Kandra Radhakanta Kundu Mahavidyalaya for inviting me here today. What I wish to talk about is not so much about the LGBT sort of community as such in particular, although certainly they will be a very large part of what I'm going to say. But it is much more about the way in which we think about love and the way in which love functions in patriarchy and the way in which the media also seems to be much in love with love and exactly where the problem in there being such a lot of love. Yes. So what I wish to talk about is not the predominance of love as such, but also the way in which love seems to have colonized sex and how love seems to have colonized lust. So there seems to be a certain kind of a notion that, of course, I mean, this is completely patriarchal. We all know how it is, but I'll expand on that later. That somehow to love is better than to be sexually attracted to someone. So somehow love is higher than sex, and sex is lower than love. And this kind of hierarchization of love and sex, that is broadly where I'm going to pitch my talk. But also, of course, I will talk specifically about Section 377 and, of course, the verdict that the Supreme Court passed on 6th of September 2018, a verdict that I myself have quite a few reservations about. So while I'm happy that homosexuality has been decriminalized in India, it's been 2 years, but of course I am not terribly excited about the verdict that was passed by the Supreme Court, because that verdict has got at least three very, very major problems. And in order to make my talk sort of, in order to link my talk to the media, I shall be showing you four magazine covers. And I hope to, therefore, it is not going to be a PPT. I actually have the copies of the magazines with me, the hard copies. So I shall be holding them up in front of the camera. And what I wish to do is to, therefore, talk about the way in which the media also seems to have become rather conservative. In the sense that when you are going to talk about love, but you're not going to talk about sex, that is a kind of neoliberal conservatism that I personally am very, very disturbed by, right? So therefore, that is broadly what I wish to talk about. Now, this whole problem of conflating love and sex and marriage, this conflation is not very old, in the sense that the whole idea of marriage being about love is really not much older than about 200 years maximum. Before that, of course, so traditionally marriage was never about love. It was certainly about property. It was about money. It was about, you know, political alliances. It was about progeny, again, property. But love as such had nothing whatsoever to do with marriage. This importing of love into marriage really happens around the 19th century. But much before that, something rather dangerous happens about, I'm not very sure about the date, but about 500 years before the birth of Christ. I'm talking about, of course, Plato's Symposium. Now, what happens in Plato's Symposium is something rather alarming, although it does not seem to be alarming at first glance, but basically that's what it becomes. Now, those of us who are familiar with Plato's Symposium will know that a symposium is basically a dinner party. So you have a lot of these people who are coming in, you know, famous people, celebrities, stars of the day. They're all coming to take part in a dinner. And of course, Greek dinners or ancient Greek dinners, at any rate, used to be excuses, or rather used to be occasions where people would discuss or they would deliberate on a particular topic. So the topic on which these people who had gathered were going to deliberate on was going to be love. So then, you know, each speaker has a time allotted to them in which they sort of say, and of course, they're all men because, you know, Greek society was very, very patriarchal in that sort of sense. So these men, they get up and they talk about love. Now, the most several people talk about love, but for our discussion here today, the most relevant thing is, of course, the most relevant speech is the one that is made by Aristophanes. Now, Aristophanes basically tells us how love came to be. Now, we all know the story, but for those of us who are unfamiliar with the story, this apparently is how love came to be. Once upon a time, human beings came in three kinds of bodies. But all bodies had four legs, four arms, and heads that were back to back. So therefore, you could actually, you had a head behind you, so you could see what was happening behind you as well. Now, the thing about these human beings is that these human beings came with three different kinds of genitalia. So there were this one human beings that had male genitalia, that had two male genitalia. Then there was this other kind of human being that had one male genitalia and one female genitalia. Then there was another kind of human being that had one female genitalia, actually two female genitalia. So these were the three kinds of human beings, and they were very powerful. The gods, of course, you know, gods have traditionally, and especially pagan gods, are extremely insecure. You may have noticed it, yes? So pagan gods are usually very, very insecure. They are constantly terrified that power is going to be taken away from them. So, you know, this, of course, also happens in ancient, in Greek mythology. So they all go to Zeus and they say, human beings are becoming too powerful. What should we do? The Zeus says, relax, let me deal with this. And he sends a thunderbolt. And the thunderbolt, of course, you know, in one of the most famous images in all of literature, cuts these human beings into half like a strand of hair cuts through a boiled egg. And so basically what happens is that, you know, human beings look like us. Two arms, two legs, one head, one genitalia, one piece of genitalia. Now, what happens is that these human beings that have been now separated, what happens is that subsequently, they constantly scour the earth to find the other half of that body. Ah, so there you have the expression other half coming in. So what happens is that those human beings who had two male genitalia, one man will constantly look for the other man and who, you know, he's going to hold on to and they are going to physically unite. Then there were these other people who had one male and one female genitalia. Of course, you know, that is how you realize heterosexuality happens. And of course, you've got those persons with two female genitalia. So that is apparently how lesbianism happens. So when you actually hear that story, you think it's a wonderfully liberating story. You think, well, that is lovely. You know, look at this wonderful story by Aristophanes. You know, homosexuals, lesbians, straight people, they're all treated at par. Yes, that is certainly true. But what really begins to happen is something far more insidious, far more dangerous, in the sense that what this otherwise rather wonderful story, what this is doing is, this is basically saying that you can only love one person in your whole damn life, right? So what it enshrines is monogamy. You see where I'm going with this. So it enshrines monogamy. And as a result of that, what begins to happen is that we tend to valorize monogamy as something that is wonderful and desirable and the greatest possible kind of romantic relationship that you can possibly have. That is the one thing. The second thing is that sex and love become interchangeable, right? So therefore, sex becomes an expression of love, which is not necessarily true. You can have very enjoyable sex with somebody that you do not love, and you can have horrible sex with somebody that you love. So therefore, just because you love somebody does not mean that the sex is going to be amazing, and just because you don't love somebody does not mean that the sex is going to be bad. But we were taught that in order for the sex to be amazing, you have to add love to it, without which it is not going to function. Now, that kind of thinking is something that skips several sort of millennia and centuries, and in a very strange way reappears atavistically in the 19th century in this sort of absolutely concretized form, where you find that love and sex and monogamy and marriage, they all are sort of, they all form this supposedly organic structure out of which there is no escape and out of which you cannot separate the elements. So you cannot think of love without marriage. You cannot think about marriage without love. You cannot think about marriage without sex. You cannot think about sex without marriage. And you cannot think of love without sex. And you cannot think of sex without love. So therefore, love, sex, and marriage, they all sort of, come together and form this incredibly toxic structure, which we are still struggling with. Many of us may pretend that we are not struggling with it, but most of us, if you're honest, we are. Now, into all of this, basically come, colonizers. And of course, the one of the most harmful legacies of the colonial enterprise is, of course, Section 377. Of course, there are many other sections that are equally toxic, equally harmful. When we talk about transgender rights, very few of us actually bother to talk about the Criminal Tribes Act of 1871. But that is a different discussion, which I'm not going to go into. So basically, the point is that in 1860, under the loving gaze of my dear friend Lord Macaulay, you have Section 377 that is written into the Indian Penal Code. For a very long time, this law remains in the Indian Penal Code. In 1947, we supposedly become independent. I'm not terribly sure. But anyway, so we become independent in 1947. But of course, the Section 377 still remains. The British decriminalized homosexuality in 1967. But of course, so exactly 20 years after India gains independence, but we still very lovingly hold on to Section 377. Now, Professor Dasgupta, in her talk, she mentioned Shakuntala Devi, and Shakuntala Devi is somebody that I should refer to in my talk as well, because of course, as you very well know now, that Shakuntala Devi in 1975, I think, if not 1976, she published this absolutely important book called The World of the Homosexuals. But hers is a lone voice, and her book for a very long time was a lone book. That book stands in splendid isolation because for the next 20 years, for the next 25 years, there was no talk about homosexuality till around 1990. There seems to be a growing movement towards the decriminalization of homosexuality. So the first concerted demonstrations in public for the abolishing or for the repealing of Section 377 begins to happen in 1991-92. Now, this is a long struggle. Kolkata has a very nascent, a very small but historically extremely significant gay pride march in 1999. which starts from Park Circus and which ends in Creek Row. About 10 to 15 people march. But remember, it is the first Pride March that happens in all of India. So the first Pride March in India actually happens in Kolkata. Now, fast forward to 2009, which is when Delhi High Court, in a landmark verdict on 2nd July, decriminalizes homosexuality between adults who have consensual sex in private. So those are the provisos that are attached. So therefore, I think this is something that we really have to understand, is that what the Delhi High Court did was the Delhi High Court basically read down Section 377. It wasn't abolished. It wasn't repealed. It wasn't destroyed. It wasn't burned. It wasn't incinerated. It was simply read down, which means that the applicability of Section 377 was restricted, which means that henceforth, Section 377 was not going to be applicable to two adults who would be having sex in private, consensually. Okay. Now, from 2009 to 2013, India experiences, I think, what can be called an interregnum, which is when you basically have a lot of publications that happen, there is a decriminalization of homosexuality. And then suddenly in 2013, homosexuality is recriminalized by the Supreme Court. So between 2009 to 2013, homosexuality becomes decriminalized. Homosexuality becomes recriminalized in 2013. And then from 2013 to 2018, so for the next 5 years, homosexuality remains criminalized all over again. Now, this is where I would want to start showing you some magazine covers. Now, it is interesting how two different magazines, one much better known than the other, how they are dealing with the 2013 verdict, right? So the first magazine that I'm going to show you is, of course, India Today. Now, if you look at this particular issue of India Today, many of you will actually find that on the cover is, of course, the Indian English writer Vikram Seth. And of course, Vikram Seth is holding up a slate that says not a criminal, no problem there, because Vikram Seth is basically outing himself as a gay man and he's saying that I'm not a criminal. Absolutely no problem there. But the problem is somewhere else. The problem is, I don't know whether you can actually read what is written in the small print, but if you can't, then I'm going to read it out to you. It basically says, and this is where the problem begins, to not be able to love the one you love is to have your life wrenched away. Oh, so poetic, so wrong. So what Vikram Seth does in all his wisdom is that he does something unconsciously patriarchal. He does something unconsciously patriarchal. What is he doing? He is talking about love, but Section 377 was never about love. It was about sex. But look at the way in which Vikram Seth, and this is what I call the gentrification of sex. Sex is made acceptable. Sex is made, to use the Bengali term, bhodro. So what basically Vikram Seth is doing is, he's turning sex into something bhodro by masking it with the term love. Vikram Seth thinks he's doing something wonderful. I think he's doing something very dangerous. Because this is what he's doing. He is actually masking sex with love. Section 377 nowhere mentions love. It is all about carnal intercourse against the order of nature. Carnal, body. The last time I checked, love has to do with the heart. Section 327 does not mention anything about the heart. So, in India, two men or two women could always fall in love and there would not be a problem. Love was never criminalized. Sex was. But Vikram Seth, by writing this, and of course, actually, this is a poem. It's a poem that Vikram Seth writes. It's a fairly long poem. And by doing that, what he's basically doing is that this is the very long poem that he writes. But in doing that, what he's actually doing is that he is diverting the attention, again, unconsciously, because I'm sure he doesn't mean to do it, but he is diverting the attention from the real problem. The problem was not love, but he's making it about love. That is what is dangerous. So that was the first magazine. Now, the second magazine that I'm going to show you, this is not a very well-known magazine, but this magazine cover, I think, is much more truthful and much more honest and gets to the point. Yes? So this particular magazine called Mandate is basically saying, we don't give a damn. We don't give a damn. Okay? Now, if you actually look at the cover, yes, there are two men who are certainly in a state of a sexual contact, but this could be a romantic contact, but it need not necessarily be. So the cover of Mandate, what it basically does is that it keeps the focus on sexuality, which is where the focus should be. The cover keeps the focus on sexuality and it does not invoke love. It does not invoke sentimentality. Because as I am, I go blue in the face saying that patriarchy functions through aesthetics and sentimentality. Patriarchy makes itself look beautiful. And of course, you know, Songjuktadi's talk, you know, must have provided you with so many examples of the way in which patriarchy uses aesthetics, right? This was very clear from Songjuktadi's presentation. So patriarchy will aestheticize its oppressive politics, but patriarchy also sentimentalizes its politics. So therefore, what really happens is patriarchy is going to sentimentalize sex by invoking love. There is actually, when you think about it, nothing sentimental about sex. Just as there is nothing sentimental about breathing, there is nothing sentimental about hunger, there is nothing sentimental about being sleepy, there is nothing sentimental about going to the toilet. These are not sentimental acts. Sex is one such. But it is the way in which we become prey to patriarchy, that we sentimentalize sex. Now, the moment Vikram Seth does that, that in a very strange way begins a whole discourse of the sentimentalization of sex, which actually culminates in the judgment that the 5-judge bench pronounces on 6th of September 2018. Now, it is very clear in the petitions that were filed, the review petitions that were filed against the 2013 Supreme Court verdict, the review petitions that were filed were very clear. They were wanting sexuality rights. Very clear. Love was nowhere mentioned. It was all about the freedom to have sex with whoever we want to, as long as it is consensual, as long as it is between adults, and as long as it is in private. That was what was asked. But when the verdict came out, which of course all of India celebrated, quite rightly in some ways, but that verdict astonishingly imported love. So then suddenly, homosexuality became homoromantic. So it all became about romance, it became about love, And I think that is where we are still stuck, unfortunately, because soon after the verdict was pronounced, a hashtag began to acquire great currency. And unfortunately, my heart sinks whenever I see it. But this incredibly horrible hashtag, I'm sure you've seen it everywhere, love is love. Section 377 was never about love, but the way in which the media and the way in which popular culture turns it into something about love, I think, is what the real problem is. So, it is therefore not particularly surprising that India Today should run this particular cover for the issue celebrating the Supreme Court verdict. Here you have two men supposedly about to kiss, and what it says over here in small print is free at last, intimate portraits of LGBTQ people, how the landmark 377 judgment changes their lives, and why the war against regressive sexual mores is far from over. So although the term sexual is actually put there in small print, but the overall message seems to be about, you guessed it, love. And of course, this continues, because if you look inside this magazine, you're going to find that there are several couples that are featured. They're all in loving relationships. Do you see where I'm going with this? So there is a kind of a homosexual monogamy that is already being circulated in the media as the ideal state to be in, right? So the message that is being given out by the so-called liberal media is that if you are gay, we love you, but please stick with one partner and be faithful to him and don't have too much sex with anybody else. Do you see where this is going? So what the Supreme Court verdict did is that it sort of gave with one hand, which it kind of again took away with the other. Because on the one hand, the verdict seems to be saying, yes, you can have sex, but then there is also this association that, yes, you can have sex as long as you are in love with the person that you're having sex with. So this invocation of love, what it does is that it, again, like I said, it is a gentrification of sex. It is the way in which sex has been traditionally controlled by patriarchy. Now that same control is being activated for the LGBT population. And what is shocking is that the LGBT population, of course, is swallowing it hook, line, and sinker, because LGBT population still now wants to aspire to the kind of toxic monogamy that has now become quite disgraced in heterosexual society, as I'm sure many of us know. The fourth and last magazine that I'm going to show is, of course, Open. And again, here, of course, two men have been replaced by two women. But of course, the overall message seems to be the same. India 2018, a love story. Yes. So then, a Supreme Court verdict decriminalizing sex becomes a love story. It should have been a sex story, but because we are all very bhadra people, because we are all gentrified, we cannot talk about sex. We can only talk about love. So what really happens, therefore, is that this astonishing, and I'm sorry, but I'll have to use this term, this astonishing colonization of sex by love is something which then becomes absolutely the controlling discourse of the way in which media begins to function, And I'm so sorry to say that is the way in which media is continuing to function today. So I am going to end this presentation by basically making us aware of the way in which media, sometimes in spite of its best intentions, can fall unwitting prey to the machinations of patriarchy. Even the most liberal media is perhaps not immune to this slippage. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. We are all amazed for such an illuminating and eye-opening lecture, sir. Well, Niladri sir has exhibited the cover pages of several magazines where we have seen that how sex is being gentrified, how sex is being masked with the term love. And 377 was not about love, but sex. It was not about love, but carnal sex. But consciously or unconsciously, media is diverting our attention. So the neoliberal conservatism of media is somehow colonizing sex by love. And patriarchy is continuing to function through sentimentality and aesthetics that culminates into the Supreme Court verdict of 2018. So we have a few questions, I guess. Well, no, we are yet to receive any questions, but still, if you want to
ask any questions.
Okay.
Ethan, can I ask a question?
Please, ma'am.
Niladri, I was wondering, did you notice some sort of a Supreme Court or a High Court order about same-sex marriage, which has been discouraged? Yes. So would you like to comment on it a little?
Oh, I'd rather not. No, but I will. No, I will. Yeah. So those of us who are aware, but those of us who are not aware, what happened was that a PIL has been filed at the Delhi Supreme Court, at the Delhi High Court, basically saying that the Hindu Marriage Act and the Special Marriage Act, they should be reinterpreted in such a way, a kind of declaration should be made in such a way that marriage becomes gender neutral. So therefore, it should no longer be mandatory for a man and a woman to get married. Two women or two men can indeed get married. That is the PIL that has been filed in the Delhi High Court. The case came up for hearing very recently, the government was asked to make its stand clear. The government, of course, not surprisingly, said that homosexuality, first of all, homosexuality is apparently against Indian culture, which baffles the imagination. But the government certainly said that even if homosexuality is now a part of Indian culture, but gay marriage is definitely against Indian culture. Okay. But be that as it may, I, Shongjukta Di, feel that the position taken by the Delhi High Court seems to be, again, a neoliberal position, because the Delhi High Court very clearly said that to the petitioners, the Delhi High Court said that please go to a marriage registry office and try to register the marriage of two men or two women. If they refuse to register your marriage, come back to us. So therefore, I think the Delhi High Court seems to have taken a very queer-friendly position over here. And I think the Delhi High Court also did not mince its words when it sort of condemned the government by saying, basically, not in so many words, but basically, please keep up with the times, get your heads out of the 19th century, come to the 21st. So the Delhi High Court position so far seems to be a commendable one. The case is going to come up for hearing again next month. And let's see what happens. But the way in which the liberal media is playing up the issue of gay marriage, with my heart sinking, I fear that gay marriage may become legal either this year or next year. And as somebody like myself who is against marriage, it's going to be a very, very depressing day.
Yeah. In fact, I'll just make one very short comment. And that is the moment there is the institution of marriage is stepping into a relationship, immediately comes in everything to do with monogamy in terms of that little competition at home because who is the big contributor. Absolutely. It's about property. It's about, and then if you adopt children, it's about, again, who goes where. So I am not really very excited about this one. I was trying to check.
I'm not either. And I'm sure, you know, I may be in a tiny, tiny minority of people who are not excited about this, because I believe that there are other things that should have been done. Employment guarantee, housing guarantee, you know, hospital visitation rights, healthcare facilities being made available to trans persons. There are so many other important issues. Marriage should not have been a priority. But unfortunately, you know, marriage is sexy. Marriage is what sells. Marriage looks good on the front page of newspapers, Shongjuktadi. So again, this is where the media is buying into patriarchy unconsciously. But thank you so much for asking that question.
Thank you, Neelaj.
So I'm sure that there are a few more questions, but actually we are running late. So I think we should move on to the next session. So thank you, sir. So now I will introduce our next speaker. It's my privilege to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Moushumi Bhattacharya. She's an associate professor of the Center for Journalism and Mass Communication, Vishwa Bharati. Her master's and PhD in journalism and mass communication degrees are from the University of Calcutta. She was attached with the Center for Culture, Media and Governance, Jamia Millia Islamia University, New Delhi, as ICSSR postdoctoral fellow. She also received the prestigious postdoctoral research grant by the International Association of Women in Radio and Television, IAWRT Focus, Norway, in 2015. She has been selected as a scholar by the US government from India for the coveted Studies in US Institutes in Journalism and Media Program, 2016. She was selected to take part as an expert in the National Mission on Education through ICT by the MHRD, Government of India, to coordinate the Media and Communication Studies of the PG Parsala's course. And she was nominated from India in the Scientific Committee of the Symposium on Asia-USA Partnership Opportunities organized by the Kennesaw State University, USA, Atlanta in 2013. She is attached with many academic bodies of the country and also with one of the curriculum development committees of the National Institute of Open Schooling, Ministry of Human Resources, Government of India. She has got many research articles to her credit as well, along with 3 edited books. She is one of the pioneering members of the Young Leader Think Tank of Frederick Ebert Stiftung, Germany. She has also been involved with the formulation of the Young Agenda of India by YLTT. She was nominated from India for an international learning project for shaping globalization held in Bonn, Germany in 2010. The title of her talk is Portrayal of Indian Politicians by Media, the Gender Paradigm. The media portrayal of politicians in India often produce gender paradigms. The male politicians received more media coverage on the basis of stereotyped leadership traits. This biased coverage likely contributes to the under and misrepresentation of gender in politics. Analyzing the differences between the media representation of male and female politicians is crucial in determining the extent of sexism and bias within mass media. And our next speaker, Dr. Bhattacharya, will possibly be explicating on these issues. So, ma'am, please stay. Hello, ma'am.
Sorry, I just unmuted myself. Good afternoon to everyone, and thank you, Bidhan, for your generous introduction. And I'm really grateful that for having me on board, and I'm really grateful to your college, Kandar Radha Kanta Kundu Mahavidyalaya, and my gratitude to Dr. Minal Kanti Chattopadhyay and others. And I have to say this, I know about Shaun Yuktadi's work and Dr. Niladri's work also, but it's actually a privilege to be in the same panel with both of you, and I'm enthralled with your deliberations. So having said that, I know that we are running out of time because there's a fourth speaker we know we have, I'm also waiting for her illuminating speech. So I have listened to her many times. So as Bidhan told about he introduced about my subject. So we all know that media and politics go hand in hand, as both depend on each other for their respective functioning. So women have always been playing important roles in politics since long, but somehow media has not been able to highlight them in a befitting manner. I'm not generalizing the media. And I will be, presenting few slides. So I'm just turning off my video right now so that I can share my screen with you all. Am I audible to you all?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you see my slides?
Yes, you are both audible and visible, ma'am.
Okay. So thank you so much. So my topic is today the portrayal of Indian politicians by media, the gender paradigm. Women globally, and especially in politics, have broken the glass ceiling. Like, they are governing nations, they are governing states, and holding pivotal positions of leading political parties. In addition to the position of German Chancellor, that of President in Greece, Estonia, Ethiopia, Trinidad and Tobago, Taiwan, Singapore, Slovakia, Croatia, Georgia, Bolivia, Malta, and Marshall Island. Yeah, I know that few countries are less known, but all this country is currently occupied by the members of the PSX, quote unquote. Prime ministerial office in New Zealand, Iceland, Namibia, Denmark, Norway, Barbados, Bangladesh, Finland, St. Martin, and Belgium are women. Aung San Suu Kyi, heading the Myanmar administration, and Kamala Harris, the vice president hopeful of the United States, are also part of the list of global powerful women leaders. Even in India, where dominance of patriarchal society and structure is overtly palpable, women politicians have successfully walked the corridors of power and risen to the highest echelons of administrative positions. Indira Gandhi, Pratibha Patel, Sushma Swaraj, Jayalalitha, Mayawati, Smriti Irani, Nirmala Sitharaman, and Mamata Banerjee, our chief minister, are relevant examples of women politicians who have and continue to wield significant power within political circles. Though she has never held any position of governance, Sonia Gandhi, Mrs. Sonia Gandhi, as president of All India National Congress, had found her place among the top 20 in the Forbes power list in 2011. Cumulatively, the journey of these personalities to the top highlights the aspect of women finding their rightful place under the sun within the political arena. However, studies of different scholars indicate such a conclusion probably contains the possibility of oversimplification of existing realities, notwithstanding the success and public support enjoyed by women leaders. Their representation by media has not always been just and kind. Anderson and Bugenard note about data made available by Global Media Monitoring Project, which came up in 2019, a credible global source, 1819 report, presenting media containing gender perspectives, indicating that only 24% of all news articles published globally focus on women or report about them. In other words, news stories about women are less than 1/4 of all stories carried by different media channels. Additionally, Global Media Monitoring Project data also brings out the fact about women presence in national parliaments across countries being only around 23%. In the publication, Invisible Women, Comparing Candidates, News Coverage in Europe, Analysis of Media Content Data, European Election Study has been presented by Louis Ten Bandiki. Basis data about how media reported on women candidates across 25 countries, the authors found reports about women aspirants being noticeably lesser than male candidates. The authors attribute this change to outlook of both media establishments and political parties. While the former shies away from reporting about women, the latter does little to motivate publications to feature women candidates more. In fact, parties display detectable nonchalance in promoting women leaders and assigning them practical positions. If and how media reporting impacts the prospects of women politicians was studied by Harrison and Bernard, taking into account data from 56 countries, analyzing performance of women candidates in elections held between 2012 and 2015. The researchers concluded about existing of noteworthy relation between prospects of such candidates and the image media portrayed via stories and articles. Wherever media representation was positive and focused on work done by women candidates, they performed well in the polls. When representation focused on their gender identity and highlighted personal attributes not in a positive light, poll performance on women candidates suffered. This emphasizes media reporting having a bearing on decision of voters and thus on the electoral fate of women candidates. Building on such findings and the emergent foundation, an attempt to analyze the impact of quality of reporting by Indian media and the prospects of women politicians of the country is made herein. Specific focus of this discussion is to comprehend how Indian media has reported about women leaders and what has been its impact on greater public acceptance or rejection of such leaders. The vitality of media coverage for electoral prospects of politicians has been explored by different researchers. These studies have largely attempted to decipher the way media has approached coverage generation of male and female politicians and the fallout it has had on their political attractiveness and appeal. We have found it in a recent data published in July this year. According to results of studies in the domain of political communication, voting behavior of electorates is regulated by the degrees of media visibility a candidate or the political party he or she is representing manages to garner. Candidates with high degree of media reporting remain consistently visible among electorates and are thus perceived to be visible and credible in comparison to other contestants. The same rule applies for political parties with visibility determining credibility and acceptance among electorates. QS and Macombs therefore maintain more a party or its candidates are featured or written about by the media, higher is the propensity among voters to support them. Herein, it is pertinent to note that quality of coverage also matters along with quantum of coverage. In other words, higher number of stories and articles by itself may not suffice in attracting interest and support of electorates. What is being written about a party or a candidate also has a bearing on decision making of voters. This has led scholars to point out to tone of coverage, trade coverage, and viability coverage as being key determinants which influences decision making by voters about whom to vote for. From this degree of influence, the media exercises over thought of voters, it has been concluded that gender-skewed reporting by the press can considerably strengthen stereotyping of women and keep them restricted to the position of others within the domain of electoral politics. In reference to trade coverage, Dalloway et al. Had qualified it as a Herculean challenge women politicians are forced to contend with. Focus of media on personal and personality traits of women leaders or candidates more than their qualifications and competences, more often than not, produces pernicious results. Such approach steers focus away from capabilities, qualities, and skills of women politicians and magnifies their gender and personal aspects. This leads to biased decision-making by electorates, remaining oblivious to leadership potential and political acumen of female candidates and leaders. This group of researchers had concluded from their study in contests pitting female candidates against male candidates, there is dominance of trade coverage and issue-based coverage remains relegated. Media approach undergoes alteration when two male politicians are embroiled in electoral contest. In such instances, issue-based coverage were found to dominate, with trade coverage pushed to the periphery. Media reportage also aids evaluation by voters of the viability of candidates they are supposed to electorally select. Viability herein refers to the ability of the candidates to discharge their responsibilities effectively and thus fulfill voter expectations. In connection to prospects of women politicians, Khan had pointed out to electorates relying on their perceived gender stereotypes to form an opinion about viability of women candidates. When media falls short of providing information which can help voters precisely assess viability, needless to say, in such cases, male leaders are perceived to be more viable than women leaders. Atkinson had clarified, voters harboring preferences towards a candidate does not necessarily imply favorable electoral decision making. Perception about viability of candidate is immensely critical in determining the fate of leaders. Women in such contexts are at a disadvantage due to media harboring bias about their viability and thus projecting them as less viable than male counterparts. This often proves detrimental to political journey and career of many women politicians. Such findings underline the value of trade and viability coverage of women, of coverage of media, and also the fact in most cases these are oddly stacked against women leaders. Exclusively of news value, presence of stereotypes and depth and nature of network are three principal influences of gendered reporting of female political figures. Identify uncommonness of information and the news it can evolve into as a leading determinant of news selection by journalists and media. Researcher Khan on the American political scenario had maintained that since women leaders are few, those in active politics were newsworthy, in terms of novelty, they satisfied news selection criteria and thus are perceived and expected to deserve attention from the press. Yet, in reality, they were seldom reported about. Women candidates scored lower on coverage count compared to men attributable to aspects of viability and trade focus of media. Stereotypes too exert influence in clouding journalistic choice. Now, Aronson explains stereotypes as characteristics perceived as common to a group irrespective of differences within members of the group. Salyu and Hellman to this added descriptive and prescriptive as kinds of stereotypes. The former describes differences between the genders, while the latter outlines what men and women should ideally do. Stereotypical males are believed to be energetic, ambitious, dominant, decisive, aggressive, independent, and confident about self. Women are supposed to be warm, hospitable, nurturing, emotional, supportive, and affectionate. Given this, women are assigned domestic responsibilities while men were made responsible of outdoor work. Actually, Professor Shamgupta Dashgupta also mentioned in her deliberation a little bit of this. I was listening to that. I mean, I am actually trying to elaborate on that. So this distinction between private and public life demarcated politics as the domain of males, interpreted to demand agility, energy, negotiation skills, and such. Politics was not thought viable for women presence. This adversely impacted viability quotient of women political leaders and such as communicated by media. Viable candidates implying mostly male candidates assumed priority in terms of news value, eroding coverage quantum of women leaders. This is a theory, role-conducted theory by Egli and Kiro. So this theory is to elucidate why women are not perceived fit for political careers. Very deep-fitting theory. According to this theory, if socially constructed characteristics of any group diverges from expectations from a social role being executed by a member of the group, it lowers probability of other members in fulfilling the role. Descriptive stereotype of women as affectionate and emotional appears at odds with need of the role of politicians, and that renders the gender not viable for such positions. Researchers add about descriptive understanding of leaders being opposed to prescriptive understanding of women, which also complicates their political advancement. Women thus seem positioned to be in contradiction to stereotypes, either descriptive or prescriptive. Adverse evaluation by media affects the tone of coverage regarding such politicians, and such is conveyed negatively. With this being the followed approach, media often indulges in exaggerated reporting of stereotype-defined behavior of women leaders. Being rich in news value, such action draws media attention and portrayal of politicians as aggressive and pushy fellows. Such incidents are scrutinized exhaustively by media, and different interpretations are presented to readers, which do not always contribute to positive image building of women politicians generally. Haas and Algerine opine that political reporters comprehend qualities required by politicians as being an extension of descriptive stereotypes of masculinity. In other words, aspects associated with masculine stereotyping are perceived as essential qualities of politicians. And since descriptive stereotype of female do not overlap with that of masculinity, media displays reluctance in projecting women as leaders with high degree of viability. these influences reporting prior to elections, whereby media reports raises doubts about capability of women politicians to withstand pressures of electoral campaigns and ultimately win elections. Referred to as horse race coverage, the primary objective of such reporting is to cast apprehension about electoral prospects of women candidates and therefore sustainability of their political careers. Following the horse race approach to reporting, media draws on professional qualification and other credentials of women leaders to justify their minimal chances of electoral wins and progression of political career path. While maintaining such discriminatory posturing against women leaders, magnanimity overflows in reportage of male leaders. Their observations, comments, and remarks are included in stories as direct quotes, enabling readers full perspective of what has been said and why it has been said. In case of women leaders, paraphrasing is the chosen option. Cumulatively, this has earned female politicians more horse race coverage, increased media introspection of professional qualification and capabilities, minimal inclusion of quotes in stories, and low viability ratings. None of these, however, holds true for politicians of the opposite gender. Bauer, researcher, notes about journalists adhering to socially accepted and established stereotyping while communicating to readers about political figures as such women politicians are depicted as sensitive, emotional, gentle, and passive, which do not render them the right fit for harboring political ambitions. In fact, there's a very recent example of Minister K.K. Shailaja of Kerala, the health minister. So there are a lot of discussions when Kerala was doing well, while dealing with COVID-19, that as because she's a health minister, a woman, so she is actually working very hard and compassionately she is trying to fulfill everything. I mean, always, not as a person, many reports we have seen, there are a lot of reports that Shailaja, K.K. Shailaja as a woman, how she is doing well, how she is doing this, how she is doing that, not as a person. And she is doing this, maybe, and then, there's a highlight on her gender. Very surprising. Anyway, as such, women politicians, as I told you, are depicted as sensitive, emotional, gentle, and passive, which do not render them the right fit for harboring political ambitions. On the other hand, male politicians are described as intelligent, ambitious, competitive, and strong-willed. And this render them well-placed to pursue their inclinations of becoming politicians. Two researchers, Hardy and Turkelson, had mentioned media's obsession with competences of women in conjunction with trait when it comes to reporting about them. Flowing from this, women are projected as capable of dealing with issues demanding compassion and sensitivity like education, environment, and as I was giving example of K.K. Shailaja, healthcare and poverty alleviation. Gender-related issues, violence against women and women welfare are the other portfolios women are deemed to best suited for. Alternatively, men being more diplomatic and assertive are portrayed as best suited for foreign policy, finance, defense, and associated departments. So in addition to prolonging the influence of gender stereotype and thereby compromising prospects of women leaders and electoral candidates, media also contributes to segregating governance assignments in line with existing stereotypes. Thus, the dominance of viability and trait factors and socially accepted gender stereotypes when it comes to reporting about female politicians emerges as the common thread detectable across several studies on the subject. Though women have and are holding different positions of administrative and political importance, their perception among journalists and media professionals appears to have remained unchanged and deeply entrenched in socially imparted learning about capabilities and competences of women to a large extent. notwithstanding its patriarchal gender perceptions, India has been open-armed to its women politicians. With each passing election, their strength in the policy-making institution has been rising. So I want to give, you know, data here. A total of 700 women candidates had contested in the 2019 general elections. We all know about it. With 78 getting elected, clocking their proportion at just over 10%. Majority of winners did not have political lineage, yet went on to win some of the most hotly contested seats. In percentage terms, the population constituted 57% of total women members of parliament, while 43% came from political families. Rimaya Haridas, the second Dalit woman to step into parliament, won the election from Kerala at 32 years of age. Whereas Prumila Bishoi got elected to the lower house at 69 years, representing areas which are economically downtrodden. So at micro level, this may appear encouraging, but considering the macro level, the exuberance somewhat fizzles out. Within a 542 member house, women presence is only 14%, implying sweeping majority of male members. In fact, for every 78 women members, there are 178 male members present in the lower house. In the upper house, of the 240 members, only 20 are women. Researcher D. Cruz maintains the ratio of women to men being even more skewed in reference to legislative assembly members. Significantly, these numbers are well below desired presence of 33% women in the houses to ensure which both leading national parties had proposed introduction of quota system. The minimal presence of female politicians in decision-making bodies, positions and structures, however, have not insulated them from attacks of our societal section. According to a report of Amnesty International, women Indian politicians receive nearly 113 vitriolic tweets daily. Threats, insults, and harassment are the reported objectives of such social media communication. Analyzing 114,716 tweets addressed to 95 female political personalities prior to 2019 elections, the report found one of every seven tweets to be obnoxious and intimidating. The increasing use of social media to ridicule, intimidate, and despise women leaders into silence has been pointed out in the report, together with proportion of such targeted acrimony being twice than what women leaders across United Kingdom and United States contained be. Amnesty also noted 55% of Muslim and 59% of marginalized section women leaders are subjected to oppressive racial and religious slurs. Kavita Krishnan, Secretary of All India Progressive Women's Association, has been repeatedly told about her appearance, skin tone, unattractive looks, personal character and dignity, and has even been advised about whom she should sleep with. Reminder of her unsuitability to be raped has also been conveyed via social media. Above notions can be linked to existing social gender bias against women, which takes the shape of trait and viability coverage in conventional media. And a victim of it has been President of Indian National Congress, Mrs. Sonia Gandhi. Researcher Yadav has questioned the emphasis on the Italian precedence of Sonia Gandhi, wondering why the same media considers Akshay Kumar, who has Canadian antecedents, to be a true Indian. Sonia's remarks post the incident of mob lynching at Palghar drew ear of a section of Indian media. Her foreign origin aspect was brought to fore as justification of her and her party's anti-Indian stance. Media continues to use this trade to overshadow her qualifications, skills, and competences as a leader and position her as an outsider. This is intricately linked to the viability aspect, wherein the media cites her lack of knowledge about Indian culture and traditions to question her true ability to lead the country. That in doing so, media has conveniently ignored her giving up on Italian citizenship, consistently appearing in public in sari and learning and delivering lectures in Hindi has been pointed out by the other researcher. Media's association with maligning campaigns can be traced to the 1970s when an advertisement depicting Ms. Manika Gandhi clad in a DCM towel found circulation and was effectively utilized by the opposition to embarrass Ms. Manika Gandhi. Prior to the 2013 Rajasthan Assembly elections, photograph of Chief Minister hopeful Vasundhara Raje exchanging a kiss with Biocon head was leaked by media, leading to a strong and derogatory campaign against the leader. Maxim magazine published a picture of bikini-wearing Khushbu, who took to politics from acting, accompanied by a sexist and vulgar caption. Khushbu lodged a complaint against the publication, which was eventually slapped with criminal charges. In the case of Gul Panag, a mocked photo of her wearing the Aam Aadmi Party cap did the rounds of media circulation even before the party had officially inducted her and announced her candidature for the Chandigarh seat. This eventually opened a barrage of technically manipulated images of the actress turned politicians presenting her in skimpy dresses and vulgar positions. Rakhi Sawant also came in for sexist and personal attack post announcing the launch of her own political outfit. Comments of men politicians that only fun-loving and seeking individuals will vote for her was published by all leading media channels, thereby influencing public perception in certain direction. The interplay of trade and viability in media reporting is clarified by each of the above examples. In fact, if you all can remember, Mrs. Smriti Irani, when what she has done or what she is doing, actually, how many of us we know, we do not know, but when she went to a Fab India outlet and she found a camera, full-on camera there, so that news actually, it went viral. So as discussed previously, media integrated viability and claims to destabilize the prospects of women politicians in India. Personal attributes and traits are by design harped on to project the politicians is a way which contradicts associated stereotype and thus positions them as diverging to Indian belief, ethos, and traditions. This divergence from perceived Indianness is then used to justify their lack of viability in winning elections and getting positions of authority and decision-making opportunities. After all, someone who does not align with the prevalent mindset of fellow countrymen will not be able to do justice to their expectation and elevate them from problems and hardship. So now I have come into the conclusion of my discussion. So if I summarize all the findings and examples which I just cited, hinging of media's dilution of public perception of women politicians on traits and viability emerges strongly. By bringing into focus traits of women running contrary to traits associated with politicians, media vehemently questions their viability to be effective and efficient representatives of electorates. That triggers doubt in mind of voters about whom they should exercise their democratic right in favor of and invariably the scale tilts towards male candidates. In the male-dominated media world, excessive reporting about personality and characteristics rather than skills and competence appears attributable to prevalent stereotyping of women. None of the associated descriptive and prescriptive stereotypes align with notions about traits of politicians, which aids media in projecting women as not being fit for the job and therefore not deserving much newsprint and, of course, airtime. Such relegation lowers their visibility compared to male leaders, placing them well behind in recall factor. Conflict between descriptive political stereotype and prescriptive female stereotype also contributes to media apathy. Premises differ, but the impact is same, and that is gender-biased approach to reporting about political personalities in general. Thank you very much for listening to me. So if you have any questions.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am, for your spectacular presentation and sensational deliberation. Dr. Bhattacharya has elaborated the differential approach of media on reporting the viabilities of male and female politicians. She has shown us how during the elections, voters are often remain unaware of the female candidates and the leadership potential of the candidates and their political acumen. This is somehow stereotyping women leaders in the domain of electoral politics, that is, day by day complicating their political advancement. Well, we are yet to receive any questions, and actually we are running half an hour late, so I think we should move on to the next session. And well, if you have any question, then you can ask the question after the final presentation. Thank you, ma'am. So without any delay, I think I should introduce our final speaker of today. It is my honor to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Swati Bhattacharya. She is a senior assistant editor. She writes opinion pieces and features in popular newspapers and magazines. She has completed her MA in philosophy from Jadavpur University and MSc in Media Research from University of Stirling, UK. She has obtained her PhD in Social Science from Tata Institute of Social Studies, Mumbai. She has received prestigious fellowships like Fulbright Fellowship, East-West Center Jefferson Fellowship, ICSSR Senior Research Fellowship, and is an active member of the EWC alumni in India. She was awarded the UNFPA Largely Media Award in 2007 and won the EU India Essay Contest for Young Journalists in 2005. She is the General Secretary of South Asian Women in Media, Indian chapter, and a member of the Calcutta Press Club. She has authored and edited several books in English and in Bengali. She will be speaking on the title of her talk is Representation of Rape in Indian Media. Well, according to the National Crime Records Bureau, 35,000 incidents of rape had occurred in India in last few years. While most of these cases don't find place in the pages or websites of media, the ones that do get reported sometimes do not get covered properly. Media organizations should not only remember the legal code, but also the ethical responsibility they have when reporting on rapes and incidents of sexual violence. Our next speaker, Dr. Bhattacharya, will be explicating on this matter. So now I would like to invite her. Ma'am, please take it over. Hello, ma'am.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, yes.
Okay, sorry. Yes. I had, it was still mute. So I was just saying that I really congratulate Kandra Radhakanta Kundu Mahabidyalay for arranging this very essential webinar. The topic is such an important one, that you know, this critical perspectives on how gender is represented in media and trying to look at its politics. It is indeed something that many of us who are working in the media, not just studying the media as Moushumi does, she did give a wonderful presentation, but also those of us who are working full-time in the media, we are also equally worried and equally anxious, because we review our own work and work of our own colleagues to think whether what we are doing is the thing that we want to do and whether we couldn't have done better. And really, is this what we want to go to our readers with at the end of the day? আমাদের মধ্যে সবসময় আত্মসমালোচনারও একটা পালা চলে, কিন্তু সে বিষয়ে বিস্তারিত বলার আগে আমি একটু আজকে আমাদের সঞ্চালককে জিজ্ঞাসা করতে চাই, বোধহয় আপনাদের ইংরেজি বিভাগে এই আলোচনা সভার আয়োজন করেছেন বলে সকলে ইংরেজিতে বললেন, তো আমি কি ইংরেজিতেই বলবো নাকি বাংলায় বলার কোনো সুযোগ আছে?
ম্যাম, অ্যাজ ইউ উইশ।
মানে এমন কি কেউ থাকতে পারেন আমার আজকের শ্রোতাদের মধ্যে যিনি বাংলায় বললে বুঝতে পারবেন না, সেরকম সম্ভাবনা কি আছে?
I'm not sure.
আচ্ছা, সেক্ষেত্রে
There are people from different states, they might not be able to understand.
Okay then. Right. In that case, I will keep to English. It's not a problem at all. Right. So I would like to talk a little bit on the representation of rape in Indian media. It is a subject that has been discussed over and over again, and many of us have felt a lot of different kinds of anxiety and misgivings. I know that many of you have many critical observations on how we do representary. And my own account will be on, you could say that this is a reflection of somebody who is actively practicing journalism. So let us go back to the incident, which I'm sure is very strong in our minds, which keeps troubling us. And this is what happened in last November, November 28, 2019, in Hyderabad. When a 27-year-old veterinary surgeon, she was found, her body was found under a culvert near a highway. She had been gang raped, she was killed, and then her body was burnt. And we know what happened, that she was threatened near a toll plaza, and subsequently she was murdered. So there was instance of police inaction. And when the news got out, there was a tremendous unleashing of public fury in media, all across media, but particularly television channels. And there was an outcry for instant justice. There was this demand that the culprits need to be apprehended immediately, and even justice has to be done immediately, that it was pointless to wait for the entire lengthy judiciary process to end. And what do we see? We saw that within 24 hours of the incident, 4 young men were apprehended. At least 2 of them, we hear, were underage. And then on December 6, all 4 of them were killed. They were shot by the police. Reportedly, they had attacked the police. It's difficult to imagine how 4 young people, along with so many people, surrounded by so many police, could try to escape. But that is what happened, reportedly. And then there was another wave of jubilation and congratulatory messages for the police for doing the right thing. Again, we find that splashed across channels and print media. Now, this, of course, is contrary to every known law. It is against human rights, definitely. These people did not stand a chance in trial. We don't even know whether these accused were the real culprits. The case also seemed to have closed. And what is troubling about the media representation of the whole affair is that during this entire time, there was a constant feedback loop that was happening. So from the channels, the reporters they embedded themselves in the public outside, people who were protesting and demanding justice. Their uncensored opinion was getting reflected in the channels. The channels themselves were running numerous social media platforms where, again, people were expressing these opinions. And the opinions for instant justice, hang the rapist, kill the rapist, were being shown in the television news bulletins underneath the news itself, and also being reflected in the way the anchors were framing the news. So this feedback loop from the street to the television channel, the newscast, newsroom, and then again from the newsroom to the streets was a constant thing, and it hyped the entire cry for instant justice to an extraordinary level. We had seen something very similar in the Nirbhaya case, but here again we find something that was that even exceeded, that sort of drew its material, its emotional upheaval from the Nirbhaya case and exceeded all known limits. This has very serious implications for media representation of rape, because how did we get to a place where the media creates a feedback loop? And how could we override all traditional safeguards of journalistic practice? You know, there are certain things to be done, certain barriers to be crossed before a piece of information can reach the newsroom and actually be published or broadcast as a piece of news. You have to check facts. You have to talk to all the parties. You have to talk to important opinion leaders, to experts, in order to get a perspective of what is happening. And then again, you have to check the copy with our own, keeping in mind the journalist's own previous experiences of similar news, how we had handled that, and what kind of feedback did we get at that point, and what justice was done to those who were affected by that time. So that is why you need experienced editors in the newsroom to handle sensitive copies. All of this was already there, and even then, this had happened. So let us try to look at what is the problem here. What is the problem of accurate and just representation of rape? This is, of course, not a new problem. Since the 80s, we have been talking about how media had basically messed up when trying to report rape. And what we find is that some of the problems still remain, but in many ways the problem has got more accentuated. Why? Partly because now media is not just in the business, I mean, it's not just media which is in the business of giving information. There was a time when media was valued primarily for giving out information. So the reports were usually in the form of he said, she said. So what is happening out there and who is saying what about that? That information was given out. But now, of course, we are in a social media regime where information just goes out from all sorts of, so political parties and leaders and just citizens themselves give out news, information on what is happening over there. And so it becomes the reporter's responsibility to provide explanation and understanding and background. This is something that Louis Bacardi, the president of Associated Press, AP, has said, that there was a time when reporting was expected to conform to the he said, she said format, but now reporting has moved beyond that, and it has become the reporter's responsibility to provide explanation and understanding and background. In other words, the reporters need to help audiences understand what a piece of information means. So it is the meaning-making function of the journalist, of media, that is now supreme. And the question that we need to ask is, how is media constructing the meaning of rape? So the question how media is representing rape is really can be translated into the question, what meaning media is making of rape? Now, the first thing that one has to keep in mind is that human relations, human behavior, human interactions are exceedingly complex. Does it even make sense to ask how many kinds of and how many ways you can love or in how many ways you can hate? Or even with the sexual relationships, can you ask how many kinds of sexuality can a person have? We all know that these vary exceedingly from person to person, from culture to culture, community to community, and there is no way one can constrict the meanings of human feelings or human interactions, behavior, relationships. And yet, we have found that rapes have been extremely restricted in their definition. So what is rape is something that the media has always taken in an extremely narrow and restrictive sense. So my experience in mainstream media has convinced me that even serious, conscientious journalists, they may find themselves unable to perform the meaning-making exercise that is so crucial to reporting rape. What happens, I mean, what we often do, I think, is that, you know, these days, all of us who use social media, especially on mobile, all the time, we are using emojis. So emojis, these are like one small faces, which is at once crying and smiling. There would be tears and a smile. And when we do that, when we give that, we are basically saying that these are very complex emotions, all in one very easily understandable symbol. And our media stories have become stamped like that. We just put a lot of complex things into one small thing, one small package, and we call it rape without going into the complexities of the relationships. So let us look at how meaning is made. So, you know, the making of meaning is not just about describing what has happened, but it is actually about the frameworks within which meaning is made. So who can be raped? Who can be accused of rape? Who can even speak of rape? Who has to acknowledge that an act of violence that has happened can be called a rape? These are the things which make it intelligible, which make it meaningful, which makes any sense to call it a rape. Let me give an example. Bhauri Devi, it's a case that we all know from the 80s. She was the first Indian woman who had come out and actually talked about her own gang rape, which had happened because she had stopped the wedding of an underage girl in her own village. And so as a retribution, she was raped by several of the girl's relatives. Now, what had happened is when Bhauri Devi, and this had happened right in front of her husband also, they were working in the field when four or five men attacked them and Bhauri was raped. So Bhauri went to the police station to complain of rape. And the police asked her, do you even know what rape means? And by this time, Bhauri was almost, you know, she was like 27, 28 years old. She has already had 3-4 children. And she was being asked, do you know what rape means? So this is I mean, I heard this directly from Bhavri Devi. She was in a she was speaking in a conference where I was also there. So she said that I told the policeman that I'm not a 10-year-old girl. Let me show you right here what rape means. So you see that the police, and so also the relatives, so also the friends, so also the doctors, can instantly doubt a woman's account of what is rape. She is not allowed to make the meaning. And unfortunately, media is also a party to that disbelief, to that lack of trust. They resist the idea that a woman whose body is violated has the right, the primary and the most important right, the most fundamental right to define what was an act of aggression. And because media has always resisted that, that is why across the world, and of course in India, we find that rapes by known people, by relatives, by friends, by boyfriends, by husbands, forget it, marital rape is not even rape, but even say by relatives of the husband's family, these are hardly ever reported in media. Why? There has been studies asking journalists that why did they not report cases where the women had someone very close, someone known to them as the sexual aggressors. And a researcher investigating media coverage of rape in the years following the Nirbhaya case of 2012 found that journalists were particularly concerned about what was a real rape and who was a true victim. As one journalist said, if you invite a boyfriend over and something happens, then if not 100%, you are involved in at least 50% in that situation. You had an idea what could happen. All crime correspondents that were interviewed for the study said that if the accused was known to the survivor, then the rape cases were fallouts of a boyfriend or a refusal to fulfill a promise of marriage. So there has been some kind of an altercation, some falling out, some difference for which the woman is now bringing the charge of rape. This is so common. This is always the first thing that the police ascribes to the woman and the journalist similarly ascribes to the woman. And in addition, there is a feeling among the journalists that these are not the stories that their readers want to read or their viewers want to look at. The result is that predominantly all the rapes that are represented in the media are rapes by strangers. So what is the meaning that is being made here? The meaning that is made here is that a violation can be called a rape, or rather a woman can be violated only by a stranger. It does not happen in homes. It does not happen with your known people. Funnily, somebody, as Bidhan Babu was actually quoting the NCRB just before my presentation, to introduce my presentation, more than 90% of rapes have always been by people who are known to the woman. In case of children, in case of girls, this is over 95-96%, practically all of them are raped either by neighbors or by relatives or by friends. So teachers. So you see how the entire representation is distorted sheerly by selection. And this is a very important ethical concern because, you know, representation means you don't represent everything that is out there. It's not just presentation. It's not reflection. Representation is not reflection. There is an element of choice. You exclude something, you include something. And the moment you are excluding something, you are making a choice. The moment you are making a choice, you are exercising your ethical judgment. And so this is where, by excluding cases of people who are known to the women, the media is distorting the meaning of rape, what rape means. From my own experience, I can tell you that when I had gone to Nundigram, it's such a place which had experienced a lot of public uprising over land, forcible taking of land. And this was, I think, 2004. Earlier than that. When I went there, there was a lot of the men had fled, and taking advantage of that, the women were tortured for 2 days. And when I asked such a woman who had just come home from hospital that who were these people who violated you? And she sort of just started pointing at the houses. So the person from that house, the person from this house, the person from the house opposite. So, you know, we never write about how women live with their violators. It is not like a one-time thing that has happened and you are now in a different place. No. A woman who has been attacked with acid, a woman who has been raped, a woman who has been beaten up very badly, all of them are forced to live in the same village, sometimes in the same house, same household with the people who have violated them. And we have never in media covered that kind of trauma. So, you see, rape can come with multiple meanings. And one of the very important meanings is breach of trust. In a protective relationship, in a relationship of mutual trust, trust is violated. And the woman is often regularly violated. So these are things that we do not take into account. Now, what happens is that by not listening to the woman, this is something that you will always find. This is a problem with media representation, is that you get to know very little about the woman herself who is violated, to see what meaning she makes of the situation. The extreme brutality of rapes that are splashed all over media, that are hyped endlessly, they sort of blind us to the fact that the woman may also have something to say. And when we go to the woman, we find that she may have something to say that is much more nuanced. It is not about one demonic monster-like person who was hiding behind a bush and took advantage of her being alone, being in the dark, being in a disadvantaged position, and basically made it an opportunistic crime and fulfilled his sexual lust. That is the story that we like hearing. That was the story of Nirbhaya, and that was the story of Priyanka in Hyderabad also. But in truth, when we go to women, we often find that women who are raped have many different things to say. It is very rare that a woman is actually speaks out in media, giving her own identity. But in our paper, The Telegraph, we did have one such account from Sushma Agarwala, who was gang raped. This happened sometimes in the early 2000s. Her first account was out in 2003. And this shows that, you know, there it is not as if there is no exchange, even while the rape is taking place. In her account, she says that she first argued with one of the boys that he should let her go because he has to think of his own future. And briefly, he did let her go. But then again, they did the crime. And afterwards, one of the boys found her glasses, her spectacles. And another boy, this boy who was giving her the spectacles, could not look her in the eye. He was too ashamed. So these are not all actions of, demented monsters. These are people, these are ordinary people. And see what meaning this woman, Sushma, she makes of the incident. These are not the actions of hardened criminals. My anger and sense of injustice is therefore not focused on them, but on the society that made them what they are. So how she is making meaning, she is not saying that these are three hardened criminals. She is saying that this is a society which has led them to believe that it is possible to behave like this and it's okay to behave like this, that boys usually do these things. So she is explaining the violation in a very different way than what usually media, which is stuck upon cases like Nirbhaya and Priyanka, would lead us to believe. And even for Bhaure, this is very true. Bhaure has also said, never just blame those few men. I said that this was a crime of sex. This was a crime against a Dalit woman, a poor Dalit woman who had dared to actually do her duty, stand up to upper caste men and tell them that they were wrong in marrying off a baby girl. And so this was their attempt to punish her and put her in her place, the place of a low caste poor woman. So the caste, class, gender, these were the main determinants of her rape. And she never has ever said anything else. Bhaure is still talking of that. She has still not got any recourse. None of the victims are punished. The case is out of the court because of lack of evidence. But Bhaure, as an old woman, still goes on talking about this incident. And she always makes it as a violence that is brought about by caste and class and patriarchy. But media always looks at rape, along with the rest of society, as a case of, as a sexual crime, a crime by strangers, a crime by a strange man on a woman, a young woman. So, and this is what we find, that what this means, I'll just discuss one more instance and I will stop. What this means basically is that the woman's meaning-making ability, the woman's right, the woman's capacity to make meaning of her own violation is denied. I always find it, you know, almost funny that if I were to cry out, look, that man has snatched my bag, a policeman would, without even stopping to ask me a question, would probably run after that man. If I were to walk into a police station and say my bag has been snatched, a case will probably be taken. But if I were to enter a police station and say I have been raped, the first thing the police will ask is a doubting question. Are you sure? What do you mean? Did you know that man? What were you doing there? What were you wearing? Why were you there at that time? So these questions are basically, it questions my claim to define a crime of sexual nature. Whereas when it is a case of a loss of a bag or, you know, some other kind of a burglary in my house, my laptop being stolen, there is no competition. There is no competitive claim from a man. So that is fine. But in the case of a sexual crime, there is an imagined, even when there is no man to do the actual locutionary act of saying that, no, this was not rape, the woman's right to define rape is instinctively and instantly challenged in the police station, often in hospitals. That's why you always get questions like, statements like, medical examination did not find evidence of rape. Which is a nonsensical statement if the woman was not a virgin. What evidence do you hope to find? What evidence were you looking for? And why should that be an important, when the courts have ruled that that is a lack of evidence does not mean there has not been no violation. So then why should that be important? But there is instantly, the first instinct of society is to doubt the woman's word. And this is something that we have been seeing repeatedly. So the last thing that I will talk about is, what is the awful, awful fallout of women's inability to define rape? This is that a woman cannot distinguish, cannot differentiate. She is not allowed to differentiate between adultery and rape. So I will give the example of the Khasle community, a communal attack in Muzaffarnagar in 2013. When the journalist Neha Dixit, she could talk to some brutalized women who had fled the village and they were living in the camps, when, because several of them had been violated within the wall compound of the village Mukhiya. These were all Muslim women who they had been violated by the Hindus, and they within the walled compound. So of the Mukhiya's home, the Panchayat Sarpanch home. So she managed to win the trust of the women who were living in the camps, and she could get, what she learned was that she could trace the identities of at least 19 women who had been raped and sodomized. But there was not a single complaint, because a local lawyer from the district says that here in Islam, rape is treated like adultery. The women will not talk for fear of being accused of adultery. Indeed, it was said that for reasons of honor, the men will not take back, the men of the community will not take back the women. Now, these were men who had themselves been brutalized and beaten up, and they had fled. But these same men won't take back the women if they actually say that they have been raped. Because the woman cannot say that this was not adultery, this was rape. Her consent has no say in this. It has no role to play. And media has also accepted this. A very large part of media is completely quiet about this. If there ever is a charge of adultery, then you know, media will not come forward and question whether the woman herself could define what rape is. Because I think that even without saying it, in the patriarchal hegemony, people instinctively realize that to give one woman the power to decide the meaning of a sexual act will willy-nilly give the same power to all women. So what is at stake here is the question whether women can decide the meaningfulness of a sexual act. And by denying the woman that power, the patriarchal society and its institutions retain the power to determine what is rape and what is not. They fix the framework within which rape can be addressed and punishments can be meted out. And the whole thing becomes how hard, how harsh, how awful, inhuman punishment you can give to the rapist. That apparently is justice. Those strangers, to them, what kind of punishment, whether they should be hanged publicly, those are the things that become the entire obsession of society and media. So after the Hyderabad rape, also we found that there were so many hashtags. I myself found about 19 hashtags which were instantly started, and they were like hashtag deaths for rapists, hashtag hang on all rapists, hashtag hang Hyderabad brutes, hang Hyderabad brutes pig, hang Muhammad Pasha, rapist ko fasi do. And there were numerous other tweets and Facebook pages, and these instantly were at the same time being reflected in traditional media. So we had headings like hang rapists in public. In parliament, people like MPs like Jaya Bachchan were saying lynch the rapists. So all of this had become, this entire thing become a competition into what worse punishment, most inhuman punishment, most instantaneous punishment that you can get the rapist. That was supposed to be the justice. But the whole thing about making our cities safer for women, giving greater dignity to women, giving faster justice to women, all of that was pushed out of the media. Safer roads, better monitoring, police responding faster to complaints of rape. All of that had become unnecessary, incidental. Beside the point, the most important point became how the degree of inhumanity of the punishment. And this is what we saw, that there was instant justice, and to this day, so-called justice, and to this day, we do not know whether the accused were actually the guilty ones, and we will never know. So media representation of rape not only decides whether a woman will get justice, whether our women will be safer, whether their violation will become riskier for certain people. It also decides whether women will have the dignity of making meaning, whether the speech of women will be given greater importance. That is the most important thing, because if your word is not taken seriously, then you are not taken seriously. The most important thing is that women should be heard. When they are heard, they will be safe. Because speech is our most important resistance to injustice and the most important tool to justice. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for your well-researched and well-introspective deliberation. So our speaker, Dr. Bhattacharya ma'am, has reflected how media is constructing the meaning of rape, how they are resisting the fundamental rights of women to define the meaning of rape. They are not allowed to differentiate rape and adultery. At the same time, she has also exhibited how media is trying to posit that the violation of women can be done by only strangers. So the representation of rape and violation of women is thus distorted, and this is a serious ethical concern, because this element of choice of excluding the known, the familiar circle, is somehow pushing the women into further insecurity. So now I will take one question. Actually, Aisha Khatun, she has a question. I will request Aisha Khatun to unmute herself and please ask the question. Aisha Khatun.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello.
Ma'am, you were talking about the meaning of rape. So, ma'am, can we connect this to the idea of structuralist approach, ma'am?
To the idea of?
Structuralist approach.
Sorry, I didn't get you.
Structuralism.
Structuralism. Yes, you can. I suppose, though I have been talking more from the point of view of the speech act theory, how you can connect it with structural theories is something that you have to figure out. I have not done it as yet.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I have another question. In our society, the women who are actually violated by men have to face
the stigma.
Ma'am, may I say in Bengali?
Haan, nishchoi, bolo.
Ma'am, actually, amader samaje jara nipirito hoy, mane মহিলারা তাদেরকে মানে রেপ হওয়ার পরেও তাদেরকে সোসাইটিতে বরং তাদেরকেই কথা শুনতে হয় সমাজের কাছে। হোয়াট ইজ ইউর টেক অন ইট ম্যাম?
এটা তো অবশ্যই তাকে চুপ করিয়ে দেওয়ার একটা খুব বড় উপায়, তাই না? যে তার ধর্ষণ যেন তারই লজ্জা, সেই নির্যাতিত হয়েছে কিন্তু লজ্জাটা যেন তারই, তাকেই সংকুচিত করা, সন্ত্রস্ত করা এবং সম্পূর্ণ চুপ করে জিনিসটা চাপা দিয়ে দেওয়ার একটা সাংঘাতিক চেষ্টা দেখা যায়। এবং এই যে আমি যাদের কথা বলছিলাম মুজাফফরনগরে, তাদের ক্ষেত্রেও তো এটাই যে যখন সেটা একেবারে সকলের চোখের সামনে হয়েছে, যখন মেয়েটির ইচ্ছার কোনো প্রশ্ন উঠতেই পারে না, তখনও কিন্তু সে রেপের সঙ্গে অ্যাডাল্টারি, অর্থাৎ তার নিজের একটা কোনো অ্যাফেয়ার ছিল তার কারণে এটা হয়েছে এমন কোনো যে সম্ভাবনা নেই, সেটা সে জোরের সঙ্গে না থাকা সত্ত্বেও সে জোরের সঙ্গে এটাকে ধর্ষণ বলতে পারছে না। ফলে আমার প্রশ্ন হচ্ছে যে সমাজের এই মনোভাবটা আমাদের কাছে অজানা নয়, কিন্তু মিডিয়া কেন সেখানে এই মনোভাবটাকে এত বেশি বলে অথবা না বলে গ্রহণ করে? এমনকি ইংরেজি সমাজ সংবাদ মাধ্যম, কারণ এরা সাধারণত কিন্তু পুরুষ ও মহিলা সমান এই যে ভ্যালু, এই যে মূল্যবোধ, তাতে বিশ্বাস করে, অন্তত তারা প্রফেস করে যে আমরা ইকুয়ালিটি অফ সেক্সেস, ইকুয়ালিটি অফ জেন্ডার, এটাই বিশ্বাস করি। অথচ কাজের বেলা দেখা যায় যে সমাজ যেখানে চুপ করে থাকতে চায় এবং চুপ করিয়ে দিতে চায়, মিডিয়া, এমনকি ইংরেজি মিডিয়াও সেখানে চুপ করে থাকে, সেও সেখানে যেতে চায় না। এটাই হচ্ছে মিডিয়ার অন্যায়, যেটা আমাদের বারবার পয়েন্ট আউট করা উচিত।
ওকে ম্যাম, থ্যাংক ইউ ম্যাম। ম্যাম, আমার আরো একটা প্রশ্ন আছে যে আমরা এখন খুবই দেখি যে ফেমিনিজম এর খুবই প্রচলন রয়েছে এখন সমাজে। তো ম্যাম, ফেমিনিজমে অনেকটা ইংরেজি সাহিত্যে যেমন পড়লে দেখা যায় যে যারা আপার ক্লাস হোয়াইট উইমেন, তারা সবসময় মানে ফেমিনিজমের কথা বললেও ব্ল্যাক যে উইমেনরা ছিলেন তাদেরকে অতটা মানে নিপীড়িত হলে বা ভায়োলেন্ট হলে তাদের প্রতি মানে তেমন কোনো চিন্তাই তারা দেখাতো না। তো ম্যাম, এখানে যে ফেমিনিজমের যে ব্যাপারটা এখন হয়, তো সেক্ষেত্রে কি ওই রেসিজমের ব্যাপারটা আমরা দেখতে পারি?
অবশ্যই সেটাকে খুব ভালো করে এক্সামিন করে দেখা উচিত। এবং এই যে বায়াসটার কথা উল্লেখ করলে, এটা অবশ্যই মানে বিদেশের মিডিয়াতেও খুব আছে। এবার যেমন আমরা জানি সেই বিখ্যাত সেন্ট্রাল পার্ক জগিং কেস, যখন একটি 28 বছরের শ্বেতাঙ্গ যুবতী সে রেপড হয়েছিল এবং খুব খারাপ ভাবে আহত হয়েছিল, সেটা নিয়ে আরো বিশাল হইচই পড়ে গেছিল। এবং তখন যারা ব্ল্যাক অ্যাক্টিভিস্ট তারা দেখিয়েছিলেন যে ওই একই মাসে নিউ ইয়র্কেরই বোধহয় 38 না 39 জন ব্ল্যাক মহিলা ধর্ষিত হয়েছেন এবং তাদের সম্পর্কে কাগজগুলো একটা কথাও লেখেনি। আমাদের এখানেও তাই, নির্ভয়া এবং এই প্রিয়াঙ্কা, এটা আমাদের অস্বীকার করার উপায় নেই যে এরা দুজনেই মধ্যবিত্ত এবং তারা মানে একজন ফিজিওথেরাপিস্ট, একজন ভেটেরিনারি সায়েন্টিস্ট, দুজনেই ডাক্তারি পেশার খুব কাছাকাছি পেশার সঙ্গে যুক্ত, এরা মিডল ক্লাস। এখন সত্যি মানে কোনো যারা ধরুন গৃহপরিচারিকা বা কোনো কারখানায় কাজ করেন, চাষের কাজ করেন, এই মেয়েদের সঙ্গে অনবরত ধর্ষণের মতো ঘটনা ঘটে চলেছে, অথচ মিডিয়া প্রায় কিছুই লিখছে না। এটা আমাদের এখানেও আছে। তবে নারীবাদের কথা যদি বলেন, নারীবাদী আন্দোলন কিন্তু যে ঘটনাগুলোকে, নির্যাতনের ঘটনাগুলোকে নিয়ে সামনে এসেছে, লড়াই করেছে সামনে রেখে, সেগুলো প্রায় সবসময়ই খুব দরিদ্র এবং প্রান্তিক মানুষেরই নির্যাতনের ঘটনা, যেমন মথুরা রেপ কেস, যেমন আমাদের ভাওরি দেবীর ঘটনা, এবং আমাদের এখানেও আমরা বারবার এরকম পড়েছি, সাহিত্যেও রয়েছে আমাদের মহাশ্বেতা দেবীর ডোপরি মেঝেনের গল্প। সুতরাং সেখানে নারীবাদের কাছে এই চ্যালেঞ্জটা বরাবরই রয়েছে, কিন্তু ভারতীয় নারীবাদ যে সম্পূর্ণত বা প্রধানত এদেরকে এড়িয়ে গিয়েছেন, অর্থাৎ যারা আদিবাসী, যারা দলিত, যারা দরিদ্র, যারা গ্রামবাসী, সেই মহিলাদের এড়িয়ে গিয়েছেন এতটা আমি বলবো না। তবে এটা অবশ্যই বলা যায় যে যতটা হওয়া উচিত হয়তো অতটা আসেনি।
Many questions, but I think I should not, or we should not illustrate the issues anymore. Before the number of participants getting further reduced, I would like to request Meenakshi to end the today's session. Meenakshi.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Bidhanda. Actually, I also have a lot of questions to ask, but still, as Bidhanda mentioned, that we are running out of time, so we have to end our discussion. It was really an intensely intellectual and power-packed panel discussion. We got the opportunity to witness the multiple aspects of the different dimensions of love, sexuality, women representation in politics, the rape culture, and how media has been continuously making, unmaking, and remaking the meanings connected to this. Really, today's lecture made us realize that we need to dismantle and reconfigure our understanding about love, sexuality, and women freedom. A new consciousness and awareness is required to evaluate the meanings that society plants in our mind. And we hope that this kind of webinars and discussions will help us to do so. So I want to thank again each and every speaker for the day for enlightening us with such wonderful presentation. Thank you so much. So now I would like to call Principal Sir. I would request him to please say a few words about today's program. Sir.
Good afternoon, everybody.
Thank you all very much for coming today. What has been discussed today has been very positive. Thanks to everyone who discussed today. I thank everyone that will be discussed again tomorrow. I wish everyone good health during this Oti Mahamari Shomoy. Namaskar. Shomoy tomader hoye geche. Sei jonno arekbar apnader sokolke dhonnobad janiye. আজকের মতো আমরা বিদায় নেব। আগামীকাল আবার আপনাদের সঙ্গে দেখা হবে। আজকে যারা আলোচনা করলেন, সংযুক্তা ম্যাডাম, ফাঁকি ম্যাডাম, মৌসুমী ম্যাডাম এবং প্রফেসর চ্যাটার্জি, তাদেরকে অনেক ধন্যবাদ। অসাধারণ হয়েছে। নমস্কার।
থ্যাংক ইউ স্যার, থ্যাংক ইউ সো মাচ। We end here today's session, but I request all the participants and all the speakers to please participate in tomorrow's session. Tomorrow is the second and the final day of this webinar, and I request all of you to please participate and make this webinar a success. Thank you so much. Have a good day.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you all the speakers. Thank you all the participants. Thank you. So we will leave here.